discover the hidden Israelite ancestry of some of the most powerful nations on earth. Watch as Scripture unveils the terrifying future of America and Great Britain as revealed through the sabbatical and jubilee years. Discover the identity of Assyria and its role in this final jubilee cycle. Learn of the pending judgments that are to be soon poured out as a result of transgressing the sabbatical years. Sightedmoon.
So let's get started. Who are the lost ten tribes? Now, some of this may be old news to some of you. Some of it may be new news. But the reason, and this is the first three chapters of my next book. And I had to put it in there because of a serious discussion, and that's putting it as politely as I can, with a couple of messianic leaders that claimed that they were two house. And I thought two house was like Judah and Ephraim, or Judah and Joseph. Well, their two house is just Judah. Judah and the other Jews. And I couldn't figure that out. I didn't understand it. So we had a pretty lively discussion about that and a whole bunch of other things. So after that, the stuff that I assumed everyone understood, I had to go back and demonstrate and prove it so that they can understand it. Like I said, I have to prove it so that you can't take my, or you can't get your butt off the wall once I've nailed it to the wall. So we're going to answer these questions, where they went and what they are called today. One of the great questions everyone asks is, we know that Gog is Russia and Magog is Russia or China, whichever one you want to pick. And they're mentioned in the Bible. But they're not the greatest nation on earth. The United States is. Britain is. And where are they? So right away the horns go up. He's talking about British Israelism and the Worldwide Church of God and Armstrong Evans, because he came out of the Worldwide Church of God. Okay. Have you ever checked it out? So someone's branded it and made it ugly looking. See, because I was also told that this book is bad for you and it's going to teach you bad things. Don't ever look at it. And if I'd believe that, I'd have never opened it. But when I, in 1994, I left the Worldwide Church of God. They were becoming Catholic. And I had to prove everything once again. And I proved everything with the British Encyclopedia Britannica. But at that time, the computer was just starting to come on stream. We didn't have all this information at your fingertips at the click of a mouse. So that was, you guys are so blessed to be able to have that today. You don't realize how much work there was involved going through an encyclopedia, tracing things name by name by name, which is what I did. I've searched my family tree. I've traced it all the way back to 892 AD by name. 892. 1300 in Scotland, 892 in France, 1400 in England, Ireland back to 1500. I've done all that, name by name. And I know what the names mean. And I know where my family comes from. And I know who I am. Everyone goes around, there's that lost generation looking for themselves. I know I grew up in that lost generation looking for themselves. Right? They were smoking pot, doing all this other stuff, trying to find themselves. So anyway, I'm getting off on a rabbit trail. I got to stick to my notes if I'm going to stay on time, right? Yeah, tell me, point to me. Okay, so this is the boring part. We're just old news to you, but you need to understand it because I'm going to ask questions as we're going. If this is happening, this is the promise to Israel, where is that in the world? Israel became a nation at the Exodus in 1379 BC. Uh-oh. Okay, that's in the prophecy of Abraham. That's by doing that chronology of the sabbatical and jubilee cycles. It's there. Prove it wrong. Prove it wrong. If you can. But you can't because I've done the work. Yes, I'm being arrogant. I'm challenging you. I want to make you mad so that you go and do it. to shut me up if you can. Because I love you. Okay? Because I care about you. 1379, the Exodus took place. It was 42 years later in 1337 that they crossed the Jordan and came into the promised land. The land of Israel was promised to the descendants of Abraham in 1809 BC when they made the when Jehovah made the covenant with Abraham. And this is what some people say that promised land was. So when did that ever happen? Well, it didn't. This is King David's empire, 1010 BC. King David's empire spanned the world, as I mentioned yesterday. We find evidence of Hebrew writing all over the place. What's the name for iron in Hebrew? Anyone know? Hang on. Anyone else? Glenn. Barzil. B-Z-L. Guess what country is called Barzil? What? Oh, I thought you said Israel. Yeah, Brazil. Brazil. Why? Because it's the iron capital of the world to this day. And King David named it because of the iron that was taken there. Northern Michigan. I mentioned this yesterday, right? They took the copper. They took that copper out of Northern Michigan to make the temple. And that copper is still in King David's tomb beneath the temple where the temple used to be. And I've seen the entrance to it. But I'm not telling anybody where that is. At the death of Solomon, 930 BC, the United Empire split between the King of Israel and the King of Judah. Now, most people have a brain cramp about this time and think that everyone is a Jew. That's an Israelite. That's like saying everyone in the United States is a Tennessean. All Tennesseans are Americans, but not all Americans are Tennesseans. You understand that? All Jews are Israelites, but not all Israelites are Jews. The 10 northern tribes are 10 northern tribes, and they were called Israel. Judah was called Judah. They were not called Israel after this separation. Why? Because the blessing of the name of Israel went to the tribe of Joseph. You need to understand that if you want to understand prophecy, because too many people are blind and say all Israelites are Jews. No. All the Israelites are in Judah in the state of Israel today. No. Israel and Judah went to war against each other. So you guys can read some of this as I'm talking. I'm just going to glance and just carry on. We're going to try and make up some time. Okay? So we got two distinct people that are mentioned in your Bible, and they go to war against each other. Israel fought against Judah. Judah fought against Israel. It's in your Bible. They are not the same people, but they are the same people. Understand that. They are, like Tennesseans are Americans, but Americans aren't Tennesseans. Not all of them. So here's the 10 tribes. This is the way they're laid out, and that's the magnitude of their empires before they went into captivity. So in Genesis 15:4, and see the word of Yehovah came to him saying, this one is not your heir, talking about Ishmael, but he who comes from your own body is your heir. And he brought him outside and said, look now forward toward the heavens and count the stars if you are able to count them. And said to him, so are your seeds. I'm even having a hard time reading that on my screen. Genesis 12:2. And I shall make you a great nation, and bless you, and make your name great, and shall be a blessing. And I shall bless those who bless you, and curse him who curses you, and in you all the clans of the earth shall be blessed. So this Manasseh tribe in northern India is more numerable than all the stars in heaven, right? No. Those tribes that they're finding in China are more numerable than all of heaven. No. Remember these blessings that are to come to Israel. In Genesis 15, verse 16, "Then in the fourth generation they shall return here, for the crookedness of the Amorites is not yet complete." What does that mean? Everyone looks at that and says, that's the fourth generation from Abraham, and that's when they come back out of the Exodus to the Promised Land. Yes, sort of, kind of. Remember the date I said for Abraham? Abraham was born in 1948, after the creation of Adam. So the creation of Adam starts with the year one on the far side. That's the first Jubilee cycle, which is 49 years. And then you count by 49 each one. So the first millennial day is 20 Jubilee cycles. 20 times 49. So a millennial day, Steve, you were asking me about this last night, and then we got sidetracked. A millennial day is 980 years. Uh-oh. They've rounded it up, folks. The second millennial day is 1960. The third millennial day is 2940. When was Abraham born? 1948. So he's at the beginning of the third millennial day. So now count four millennial days from there. So you count the orange as one, because it's at the beginning, so you count all of it. The red one is two. The blue column is three. And at the end of the fourth millennial day is the purple one. You see the date down there? 5880. 5880 matches our date of 2045. Now this is in the prophets of Abraham. It's there. I compare them back to four so you can see the both calendars together. 5880 is 2045. That means that right now we are in the year 5849. 5849. Where's 5849 in here? Right near the end of this fourth day from Abraham. Do you see that? If you don't see it, it's in the prophecies of Abraham. We don't have any prophecies of Abraham here to give away or sell. You can get them on my website and order them. But this is in that book. And that's why it's there, to show you that the fourth day from Abraham, the fourth millennial day, is right where we are now when we are about to go back to the land. But we're not going back the way many people are teaching you. And I'm going to show that to you this week. Genesis 17, verse 5. "And no longer is your name called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, because I shall make you a father of many nations." Not one, many nations. How many states of Israel are there? How many Israelite nations are there? 13 plus more. 13 is 13 tribes of Israel. And some of those Israelite tribes have developed other tribes. And we're going to show you that. "And I shall establish my covenant." There's that covenant again. The covenant keeps coming up all through this teaching all week long. "Between me and you and your seed after you in their generations for an everlasting covenant to be Elohim to you and your seed after you. And I shall give to you and your seed after you the land of your sojournings, all the land of Canaan, and an everlasting possession, and I shall be their Elohim." A great nation, multiple nations. Where is that if it's the Jews? Okay, the state of Israel and the state of New York. Doesn't fly, folks. Doesn't fly. Genesis 25, here's another blessing. "Now Abram gave all that he had to Isaac. But to the sons of the concubines whom Abram had, Abram gave gifts while he was still living and sent them away from his sons Isaac," sorry, my Hebrew's bad, "eastward towards the land of the east." Isaac inherited everything. What I'm going to show you today is that there are tribes named Isaac in history, in your Encyclopedia Britannica. All you got to do is open it up and look at it. All you got to do is hit Google Because this information is there. Now, that your seed possess the gate of their enemies. So the Manasseh tribe possesses the gate of their enemies, right? Judah possesses the gate of all their enemies. No, not even Judah does this. Here's a gate. This is called Gibraltar. A gate is a passageway from one side to another that is a narrow entrance way that is controlled by an army. Who controls Gibraltar? Britain. Who wants it? Spain. But Britain's not giving it up. Genesis 26, verse 3. Sojourn in this land, and I shall be with you and bless you, for I give all these lands to you and your seed. And I shall establish the oath. What is the oath? It's the covenant. What is the feast of weeks? It's the feast of oath. And because we broke that oath, we're going to pay a dear price. It comes up over and over and over. And I'm going to be a broken record to you, and you're going to be so sick and tired of me telling you this, but by the end you'll know, I hope. And I shall increase your seed like the stars of the heavens, and I shall give all these lands to your seed, and in your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. So he's talking Isaac now. Because Abram obeyed my voice. And remember what I said yesterday? Guarded my charge. Guarded my Sabbaths, my commands, my laws, and my Torah. When you guard something, you protect it. You don't let people trample all over it. Nobody comes to my house and does business on Shabbat. People try to sell me windows on Shabbat. Every Shabbat. So we don't answer the phone no more. Guard the Sabbath. Make it a part of your way of life. Genesis 26:60. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, so Rebekah is now going to be Jacob's wife. Let our sister become the mother of thousands of ten thousands, and let your seed possess the gates of those who hate them. So there's that possession of the gates again. Interesting, it's come up again. Now here's something that I find that most people read over and don't quite get, but this is such an important clue to who you are. Genesis 25:22, and within her, this is Tamar. Within her, the children struggled together, and she said, if all is right, why am I this way? So she went and asked Jehovah, and Jehovah said to her, two nations are within your womb. Two nations. Who's this? Tamar. Two nations are within your womb, and two peoples shall be separated from your body. And one people shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. This is Tamar. What's going on here? Is it? Good. I'm glad you're paying attention. That was a test. Thank you, Rebecca. And the first came out red all over like a hairy garment, so they called his name Esau. I've actually got the wrong slide up here. And afterward, his brother came out. That's the right slide. So his name was called Jacob. And you all know the story. Esau comes in looking for he's starving after going hunting, and he wants food. And Jacob, being the good Jew boy that he is, sells it to him. Jacob wasn't Jewish, folks. There were no Jews alive at this time. So stop the bigotry and the anti-Semitic statements that come out of people's mouths. Correct them. That's not right. Jacob wasn't Jewish. But you know this story. So he sells it. He sold his birthright for that. Now notice also that Esau was a hunter. Because that's another clue. Jeremiah says, I will send you fishers to fish you out. Yeshua says, I'll make you fishers of men. But Jeremiah also says, afterwards, I'm going to send hunters to hunt you out of the clefts and rocks that you're hiding in. Who's he talking about? He's talking about Esau. That's why I talked about the Muslim thing today. They're coming. And they're going to hunt you out of the rocks and caves that you're hiding in. So now, Jacob does a little double cross on his old man. And he fools him to get the birthright blessing. But the birthright blessing was already given to Rebekah, so he didn't have to do this. But he did. So here we have the blessings. 27, Genesis 27. Let people serve you, and nations bow down to you. Be master over your brothers. So who's his brother? Esau. And your mother's son bow down to you. Cursed be those who cursing you, and blessed be those blessing you. The birthright belonging naturally to the firstborn son. To attain this blessing from his father, Jacob resorted to tricking the blind, aged Isaac into believing he was Esau. So we know that. But Esau also gets a blessing. Genesis 27:37. Isaac answered Esau, "See, I have made him your master, and all his brothers I have given to him as servants, and I have sustained him with grain and wine. And what then shall I do for you, my son?" Isaac talking to Esau. Now listen carefully. And Isaac his father answered and said to him, "See, your dwelling is of the fatness of the earth." They got all the oil. "And of the dew of the heavens from above. And by your sword you are to live. And serve your brother. And it shall be when you grow restless." What's on the nightly news, folks? "When you grow restless, that you shall break his yoke from your neck." Esau is getting restless right now. It's called the Arab Spring. It's still going on. It's going on in Syria. This stuff is happening right now. And you're all going, I don't know about you, but the ones I see, wake up. Wake up. And Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and commanded him and said to him, "Do not take a wife from the daughters of Canaan. Arise, go to Padan Aram." That's where I have my vineyard right now. That's so cool. "To the houses of Bethuel, your mother's father, and take a wife for yourself from there, from the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. And Jehovah bless you and Genesis 28:3. "And Jehovah bless you and make you bear fruit and increase you, and you it shall become an assembly of peoples." What's an assembly of peoples? A commonwealth. A commonwealth. Where's that in the world? Where's the commonwealth of China? Where's the commonwealth of Russia? Where's the commonwealth of India? The only commonwealth I know of is Britain, of which Canada, one of the greatest nations on earth, is a part of which Australia, one of the second greatest nations on earth, is a part of. And New Zealand, no one here from New Zealand, is one of the last greatest nations on earth, of which the United States and all those rebellious Yanks are also a part of. Because the loyalists stayed with England after the war. And we're going to show you where you got your name from. So Jacob goes out to get his wife, and he falls asleep, and he has a dream, and he sees this ladder going up to heaven, and he sees the angels coming back and forth, and Jehovah tells him these promises again. You can read that in Genesis 28. But he takes that stone, and he anoints that stone. And you'll read about this stone throughout your Bible. The pillar stone that all the kings of Israel had to be anointed on. And Jacob set it up. It's a column in Elohim's house. This is a stone in Jehovah's temple. "I am the El of Bethel, where you anointed the standing column." See, even Jehovah took notice of this column. This is a very special column. Here's Bethel. See it in relation to Jerusalem. And Jehovah, Genesis 35, verse 1, and Elohim said to Jacob, arise, go up from Bethel and dwell there, and make an altar there to El, who appeared to you when you fled from the face of Esau, your brother. And Jacob said to his household and to all who were with him, put away the foreign mighty ones that are among you. Who had them? Rebecca. Or Rachel. Rachel. I'm getting my women all mixed up today. That's okay. It's early. I'm allowed to be dopey too. And let us arise and go up from Bethel, and let me make there an altar to El. We're looking for that altar right now. We found one at the two mountains, the mountains of blessings and cursings. I was on the wrong mountain last year. So they put away all their idols and they kept on going. Let's see. So here we read of that pillar again in 2 Kings 11. And he brought out the son of sovereign and put on him the diamonds and the witness, and they set him up to reign and anointed him, and they clapped their hands and said, let the king live. Long live the king. You say that every time you elect the president. No, you don't. We do. Long live the queen. We say that in Canada. Because it's a tradition that started right here in 2 Kings. And Athaliah, that wicked woman that I told you about yesterday, those four people that were removed, blotted out, Athaliah heard the noise of the runners of the people, and she came to the people into the house of the Lord, the house of Jehovah, and looked and saw the sovereign standing by the column, by that stone that Jacob had slept on. There it is, right there. That's where they anointed the king. 2 Kings 23:1. And the king sent, and they gathered to him all the elders of Judah and all of Jerusalem. And the king went up to the house of Jehovah, and all the men of Judah and all the people of Jerusalem with him, and the priests and the prophets and all the people. This is a big deal. What's going on here? From the small even to the great. And he read all the words of the book of the covenant. Oh, there's the covenant again. Which was found in the house of Jehovah, so that they could hear it in their ears. And the king stood by the pillar, the column, the same stone that Jacob slept on, and made his covenant before Jehovah. They made the covenant before the stone again. What is the stone that Jacob had? Where is it today? That stone was just taken from England back to Scotland. That's what these people are doing here. It's a big deal in Scotland. How many of you are Scotch? See, I wouldn't admit it too much because they're pretty dang stubborn. How many of you are Irish? Oh, so that takes care of the Scottish people. How many of you are English? How many of you are Newfie? We win. Newfoundlanders, for all you guys who don't know what a Newfie is. We're the funny people from the far eastern coast of Canada. This rock is important in Scotland. And they say this rock came from that column. And it's got broken half. Now there's two of them. And if that rock ain't underneath the throne of the queen or the king when he's anointed, they aren't the king or queen. There it is. There's the rock under the throne of King James that all the kings and queens have been sitting on since that time. The Liophel does not translate as big stone, and it is Gaelic. And Steve and I were talking about Gaelic last night. It's called the Stone of Destiny, Jacob's Pillar. And there's a myth that goes with it, that it would cry out beneath the king who took the sovereignty of Ireland. There's another myth that a red-headed freckled boy will come by and the stone will cry out. That's an Irish myth. What's that mean? What's that got to do? Well, didn't Yeshua say when he's walking up to the temple that shut those guys up? Don't let them call you the Hosanna. He said, if they don't do it, the stones will do it. What's he talking about? He's talking about the stones. Here's Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth, and you can call Her Majesty too, because this is your queen, the line of King David. You don't believe me yet. I'm not even started. I got off on a little rabbit trail when I was doing my notes, and I just had to keep going here. Here's a memorial. This is in Ireland, where they first brought the stone. Guess what part of Ireland? What's the part of Ireland always in trouble? The Northern Irish. But that's where the stone is. Why? Oh. It's in Tara. Tara is in Northern Ireland. Okay, I got to chew my tongue off here and stay to my notes because I don't want to get too far ahead. The other way I can be done in 5 minutes and you still won't believe it. I got to present you the proofs. I got to prove it to you. Genesis 35, verse 10. And Elam said to him, your name is Jacob. Your name is no longer called Jacob, but Israel. Israel is your name. So he called his name Israel. And this is where we get the name Israel to this day. And you all know, this is old news. But Jacob had 12 sons. Under Leah, he had Reuben, Levi, Judah, Simeon, Issachar, Zebulun, and Daniel. And the numbers there are the order they were born in. Okay? With Zilpah, he had Gad and Asher. With Rachel, he had Joseph and Benjamin. With Bilhah, he had Dan and Naphtali. And these are 12 tribes. And these four women are different, and they got different genes, and that's why the children there look a little bit different, but also look the same. I like looking at a garden that has lots of different flowers instead of all one bunch. But one bunch is also beautiful too. And that's what Jehovah is doing. He's mixing up his children to look beautiful in all different shapes and sizes. 1 Chronicles 5:1. As for the sons of Reuben, okay, so you know the story of Reuben? He profaned his father's bed. Who are the Reubenites? They're the French. Why are they French? Because they're Reubenites. What is the thing about Reuben? He has this hormone that wants to get into bed with his stepmom. But his stepmom is a lot younger. So he's about the same age as Reuben. Now we call that the French romantic thing. Everything French is romantic. Je parle français, je suis mon romantic aussi, no? That's a trait. It's a national trait. So because of that, Reuben lost the birthright. So the name of Israel never went to Reuben. And you see that in Reuben today. Reuben is unstable as water. That's his symbol. We're going to get to that a little bit later. He's unstable as water. What happened during the 1800s? Reuben, the firstborn, took over almost all of North America. What's that, the Louisiana Treaty? Is that what happened? What? Louisiana Purchase. How much did you guys pay for that? Yeah, not too much. It was in Canadian funds. Okay, so Reuben had this land. You all could be speaking French right now. Some of you have got French names. Mr. Côté. Monsieur Dumont. That's moi. When the French come down, they came down the Mississippi, and my ancestors were one of the first ones down the Mississippi River. It's recorded in our history books in Canada. That's awesome. They seen this land in its prime. Then the Americans took over and wrecked it. Little shots. Okay? Genesis 48:15. This is another blessing. This is a blessing of Jacob on his 12 sons, but now he does something different. The firstborn of Joseph was supposed to be blessed with the right hand. But Jacob, he's old, he's senile, and he goes, right? You've read the story, but this is very significant because it's also prophetic, but Jacob did it on purpose. The younger one is going to be greater than the older one. And the younger one is going to get the blessing, but the older one is also going to get the blessing. Read this. What's he talking about? Who's he talking about?
You, the American people, came out of Britain, the older one. You came out of us, and you are greater than us. And you are us. And I say us as the British, Canada, Australia, New Zealand. That's not okay. And we have people from, except New Zealand here today. Amazing. So this blessing is very significant. And Joseph got upset and tried to stop it. What did Jacob say? But Joseph thought it was evil. Jacob says in the next word, but his father refused to say, I know my son, I know. He also becomes a people, and he also is great. And yet his younger brother is greater than he, and his seed has become the completeness of nations. And he blessed him on that day, saying, in you, Israel, shall bless, saying, he will make you as Ephraim and as Manasseh. Thus he put Ephraim before Manasseh. What did he just do? He just passed the name of Israel onto
Ephraim. The name, Israel, is not the state of Israel. It's not Jewish. It's Ephraim. Do you get that? Do you understand that? Do you see the thing? Because they've named the state of Israel, the state of Israel, but they've robbed you of your name and confused you and all this stuff that everyone's trying to tell you about. That's confusing. Keep it simple. Go back. It's very simple. Follow the line. One step at a time. You know, Lego blocks. Right? If, remember I told you how to count to seven? Get your seven-year-old kid to show you. Lego blocks. One on top of the other. While the spirit of prophecy was still upon Jacob, he called all his sons together to tell them what their posterity would become, should become. When? In the last days. Today. The last days, among other prophetic utterances, of which we shall speak later, this is me talking, I thought I was reading the scripture, was the following concerning Judah and the scepter. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. So we're going to cover that more now. Nor a lawgiver from between his feet. So now Judah goes around telling me in Israel, you got to obey me because I'm Judah the lawgiver. But I'm not keeping Torah exactly the way it says, but I got authority to change that. And they use this verse. Okay, I'm going off in a rapture. I'll stop right now. That's not right. You keep the Torah the way it says to keep it. Don't let any man tell you to change it and do it some other way. Not me, not your father, not your brother, no one. It says how to keep the Torah, and all you got to do is read it. It's simple. And Jacob called his sons and said, gather together so that I declare to you what shall befall you in the last days. Gather together and hear, you sons of Jacob, and listen to Israel your father. Now, we're going to be talking, I'm not sure where I'm going yet, but we're going to be talking about some heraldry later today, and I want you to pay attention to these symbols. Reuben, you are my firstborn, my power, and the beginning of my... So imagine you talking to your own son. And the beginning of my strength, the excellency. So this is what the French do. We think we're pretty good. We should have power because we're French. In Quebec, we have French law, so you can't speak English or any other language in the province of Quebec. Why? Because we're French, and we're the best, and we're the French. That's what the French, you know, I love the French. You know, that's my ancestry. The excellency of exaltation and the excellency of power. And this is a symbol for Reuben. In messianic circles too. Reuben's two symbols are man and water. The primary symbols. Boiling like water. So this is what Jacob's now saying to him. Boiling like water, you do not excel because you went up to your father's bed, then you defiled it. He went up to my couch. What does boiling like water? What's that unstable mean? If you look at the French government, how many parliaments have they had? How many constitutions have they had? Lots. Unstable as water. They keep mixing things up because they can't fix it and say, that's it, that's the way it's going to be. No, we're going to change the next election. And we're going to have the next election in 2 years instead of four or five or six. That's the French. So, here's the next one. Simeon and Levi are brothers. Their weapons are implements of violence. Let my being not enter their council. Let my esteem not be united to their assembly, because they slew a man in their displeasure, and they lamed an ox in pleasure. Cursed be their displeasure, for it is fierce, and their wrath, for it is cruel. And I divide them in Jacob, and scatter them in Israel. Wow. How many of you are Simeonites? No volunteers. How many of you are Levites? Oh man. Okay, let me ask you this. How many of you know your family crest? Got one? Oh, we got a few hands. Okay. How many of you have in that family crest from Scotland, Ireland, England, a sword on it? Oh, there's a Levite, there's a Simeonite back there. This is you, brother. Man, I wish I hadn't put my hand up. But Simeon had a great nation. And you all know the history of that. Let me tell you who some of them are. The Trojans. The Trojans. Some of the best military men in the world are Simeonites. We need Simeonites in almost every nation because they are our military strength. That's what they're good at. See, I'm good at organizing stuff. That's what I do at work to bring things. I'm not good at doing everything individually. I bring lots of people in that they can do it. We have our talents, and these are God-given talents that we've inherited. Simeon is military. Levi is military. Why? Because they slew Shechem. Remember that story? This is where this comes from. But they did it because he raped their sister. So it's kind of like a righteous justice. Simeon, Levi, here's their secondary symbol. How many of you guys that didn't put up your hand have this symbol in your family crest? A castle. No? That's a great phone call. Okay, for you guys who can't hear this on the video, somebody's phone is sounding like the trumpet blast, and we all just stopped and listened. And awesome. And now someone's leaving with a real red face. I got to get that on my phone, but I still got a flip phone. Here's another symbol for Levi. A castle. And you'll see that on family crests all over the place. Because Levi and Simeon are scattered amongst the 12 tribes. How many of you got a lion on your family crest? This is a symbol for Judah. And you see that in Israel today, the Lion of Judah. Right? And you, Judah, your brothers praise you. Now count, pay attention here, count. Your brothers praise you. Your hand is on their neck, is on the neck of your enemies. Your father's children bow down to you, before you. Judah is a lion's cub. And the prey you have gone up. From the prey you have gone up, my son. He bowed down and he crouched like a lion. And a lion who does not rouse him. The scepter shall not turn aside from Yehuda, nor a lawgiver from beneath his feet until Shiloh comes. And to him is the obedience of peoples. Binding his donkey to the vine and the donkey's colt to the choice vine, he washed his garments in wine and his robes in the blood of grapes. His eyes are darker than wine and his teeth whiter than milk. Here's a clue. How many times did they say lion? Or three times. That's why they got three lions on there. Right? That's a symbol. That's a symbol for Judah. You ever see these symbols anywhere? Yeah? No? Yeah? Yeah? Come on. Yeah? They're everywhere. Not just in Judah. Who said England? Right. Zebulun dwells in the seashores. He is for a haven for ships, and his brother is unto Zion. And that's his symbol. So now we're going to get into some of the lesser brothers. The symbols are a little bit harder to identify and put your thumb on it. But this is what people are coming up with. Issachar is a strong donkey lying down between two burdens, and he saw that a resting place was good and that the land was pleasant, and he inclined his shoulder to bear the burden and became a subject to slave labor. Now, that's a strange blessing. But this is, you're not looking at a person now, you're looking at nations. What nations are doing this? Finland. Finland. Hey, we got a Finn back there. Did I tell you who Zebulun was? I didn't mention that. Any Dutch here? No Dutch? Come on, there's got to be Dutch people here. Wooden shoes, wooden head, wooden listen. Ah, there's one. All right, she recognized herself. But that describes all of Israel. Stubborn, stiff-necked. All of us. All of us. Zebulun is Holland. They push back the sea. They suck the choice minerals out of the sea floor. Dan. Dan's symbol, what's that symbol look like to you? Dan rightly rules his people as one of the tribes of Israel. So what's Dan? He's a judge. What does Daniel mean? Judge? Does it not mean judge in Hebrew? Dan is a serpent by the way, an adder in by the path that bites the horse's heel so that his rider falls backward. And guess what? One of the other symbols for Dan is a white horse. Who are the Irish? This is your symbol. The eagle. Dan. Who are Danish? Danish is Dan. Because Dan named everything after their father Dan. Everywhere you find a Dan, the Danube, the Dniber, the Neese, is Dan, Denmark. They're Dan. Gad, a riding band raids him, but he raids its heels. Now there's a weird blessing. Any Swiss? No Swiss? They suspect this is Switzerland. Bread from Asher is rich, and he gives delicacies of a sovereign. So here's a national trait for Asher. This is Belgium. Belgium. It's a cup that you serve to the king. Naphtali. I like Naphtali. You're going to laugh here in a minute. Naphtali is a deer let loose. He gives words of elegance. So he speaks wise words. What's a deer let loose? Naphtali breeds with anything that moves. You find the remnants of Naphtali all over the place. Northern India. You know where the caste system comes from in northern India? Or India? You got the blacks, you got the browns, and you got the light scudder. And they call this religion that they keep Abram. It comes from Abraham. It's been perverted after the years, but that's what they do. Why? Because the Naphtalites mixed in with the northern Indians people. Naphtali also went over to China. I'm getting ahead of myself. But then they moved up to Norway and Sweden. The equality of the sexes in Sweden took hold long before many other countries experienced the same trend. The incidence of premarital sex exceeds 90%, and divorce is granted on almost any grounds. Much pornography comes out of Sweden. And when I told you about Eastern Turkey and the Muslim people looking at blonde women dancing around singing, they see Swedes. Benjamin is a wolf that tears in the morning and eats prey, and at night he divides a spoil. Who has a wolf as their symbol in your family tree? Okay, the Australians come from England, right? They were the prisoners that they didn't want in England, so they shipped them all to Australia as prisoners, and they let them go down there. England was invaded by the Vikings. The Viking symbol is a wolf. A lot of the Vikings are Benjamites. Here we go. Joseph is an offshoot of a fruit-bearing tree, an offshoot of a fruit-bearing tree by a fountain. His branch run over the wall. And pay attention to this one, because this is going to come back later. And the archers of bitterly grieved him, shot at him and hated him. What are archers? What are modern-day archers? Missiles. So what's a bow? The missile launcher. Who's Joseph? I'm saying it's you and me. His two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Joseph is going to be grieved by missiles. Do you see that right here? Read it again. And the archers have bitterly grieved him, shot at him, and they just love Americans all around the world. No. The only place that you guys might be loved is Canada, because everywhere around the world, you're hated. Sorry to tell you that, but you are. You are the great Satan. The little Satan is Israel, your brother, Judah. Why is that only those two countries are hated in the world? Because you're related. This is what I'm trying to show you. These things are related, you're related, and that's why you're hated. Yeah, maybe some of your government policies are kind of, okay, Joe, they pack heat here, shut up. Verse 24, but his bow remained in strength, and the arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty one of Jacob. And there is the shepherd, the stone of Israel, from El of your father who helps you, and by the Almighty who blesses you, and blesses you of the heavens above, blessings of the deep that lies beneath, blessings of the beast and of the womb, of the breast and of the womb. The blessings of your father have excelled the blessings of my ancestors up to the limit of their everlasting hills. They are on the head of Joseph and on the crown of the head of him who is separated from his brothers. This is a great blessing that we have been given. And there's the symbols for Joseph, a bull and a unicorn. How can a mythical symbol of a unicorn become a symbol? Because the unicorns all missed the boat with Noah, so they shouldn't even know about them in this day. But if you look in your old King James, the unicorn's mentioned there many times, and when you look it up, it's a prophecy. Where do you see the unicorn today in your family crest? Standing on one side of the shield of England. On the other side of the shield of England is the lion. Now notice something about, well, we'll get that in a minute. I'm jumping ahead, but just pay attention. But there's also the bull. What's the nickname for England? John Bull. That same symbol of John Bull is called Uncle Sam. Same symbol. Go figure. They're brothers. Joseph is an offshoot of a fruit-bearing tree. Oh, I just read that. Here's the other symbols for Joseph. You recognize those symbols? See, I've got sheaves of wheat, my family. This is Manasseh. The arrows, where do you guys see the arrows? I don't know, we're in the States. Yeah, James doesn't know, he wouldn't know that symbol. I don't know, maybe. Where do you guys see the olive leaf and the branches and the olives? 13 olives, 13 leaves, 13 arrows. It's your crest. Here's a symbol for another symbol for Levi. Do you have that in your family crest? There's the unicorn. There's the lion. That's the symbol for England. Notice that the unicorn is chained to the ground. Why? Because the unicorn went into captivity and never come back. The unicorn represents Israel. The lion represents Judah, and the crown is on the lion. There is no crown on the unicorn. These are symbols that you see every day when you go out and look, and you don't have to look very far. They're part of your family tree. This is heraldry. Heraldry is the most regulated and regulated. I can't think of the other word. You can't just pick your own symbols. You got to have them passed down to you. And then if you want a different one, it's added in specifically. Notice the crest in the middle. Remember the three lions? There's three lions there in the two diagonal corners. And then there's another lion standing up. Who has that symbol of the lion standing up, the red lion standing up? That's Scotland. I thought we had some Scots here. Oh, that's me. You forgot who you were. Look at your symbol there, the red lion. The three lions is the royal line, Judah, England. But they also got the harp. Where'd the harp come from? King David. What nation has a harp? Ireland. That's their national flag. King David came to Ireland. What? I thought they were just a little bunch of people, never got off the map, never moved out to Israel. No, he had an empire that circumnavigated the world. He came to Ireland. He visited Ireland. They loved him. They made the harp their symbol after him. And there's so much more to that. See the red poppy down here? What's that a symbol of? What's the national symbol for the state of Israel? What's the national flower? You name your daughters after it. And I can't think of it off the top of my head. I just forgot it. Say what? Help me out. The Rose of Sharon? Yeah, I think that's it. I got it in my notes. We'll see if I come across it. We got 13 bars. We got 13 olive leaves. We got 13 arrows. Why do we have the Star of David above the eagle's head? Do you see the Star of David there? In the stars. But something even more incredible. The Star of David, the stars are inside a Shekinah, the cloud that covered the mercy seat. How do we get that symbol here for the United States, the bunch of Yanks that rebelled against the King of England? The 13 colonies. Why did you have 13 colonies? Jehovah's trying to show you something on an ongoing basis. You're part of the 13 tribes of Israel. How did we get 13? What happened? Oh, yeah. Joseph was changed to Manasseh and Ephraim, and they became Jacob's sons. So instead of 12, there's 13. Right? It's not just Judah. 13 stripes, 13 founding states, 13. Lucky number 13. No, it's 8. It's a very blessed number. Okay, here's the Royal Coat of Arms for Scotland. I got to read this because I really want you to learn this. When I found this, this was wow. In the book of Revelation, and referring to himself, Yeshua says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. The significance of this is that Alpha and Omega are the first and the last letters of the alphabet of the Greek language in which the New Covenant, New Testament was written. And by using them as a name for himself, Yeshua is emphasizing his identity with the one eternal and everlasting Jehovah, the first and the last of all things. Because we're talking about something that's right there in front of your face. And you don't see it. I'm jumping up and down because this is so cool. And you don't see it. These two letters in the Hebrew alphabet are the Aleph and the Tav. Okay, you know that. You guys are all pretty good at Hebrew. I'm not. And in the original Hebrew, the alphabet, the original Hebrew alphabet, the Aleph, appears as a diagonal cross as an X, such as the white X in the blue flag over top of the unicorn. And the Tav is an upright cross, such as the red cross over top of the lion. Thus, when combined as a symbol to express the idea of eternal Yehovah, they would appear like the cross on Britain's shield and the flags of Britain. They're also on the Celtic and Israelite flags of northern Spain and the Union Jack. In Or Torah, which is the name of a book, O-R Torah, by Rabbi Dov Ber, B-E-R, the Magid of Meseretz, he explained first words of Torah, Bereshit bara Elohim et. Okay, I'm very bad at Hebrew, so please forgive me. Genesis 1:1. In Hebrew, Bereshit bara Elohim et. Note that the et, E-T, is an untranslatable word used to indicate that a definite direct object is next. Bereshit bara Elohim et. Thus, there needs to be an et before the heavens and the earth. But Dov Ber, the author of this book, points out that et is spelled, listen carefully, the et is spelled Aleph Tav, an abbreviation of Aleph Bet. Aleph is the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Since Jehovah did this before creating the heavens and the earth, the letters are considered to be the primordial building blocks of the creation, of all creation. The Aleph is the X being held by the unicorn of Israel, and the Tav is the cross being held by the Lion of Judah. And this is the symbols of the Union Jack of Great Britain. It's right there, who you are. And these symbols of the Union Jack in Britain and Great Britain and the Lion of Judah are everywhere in England. A covenant people. In Isaiah 49, a prophecy for the end times, Jehovah God said, "Listen to me, you islands." Hold it. "Listen to me, you islands." Who's he talking about? He's talking about the land of Israel. "Hear this, you distant nations." Who's he talking to? Israel. Isaiah 49:1. "This is a message to the scattered nations of the northern kingdom of Israel. Jehovah is saying to them, in the time of my favor, I will answer you. And in the day of salvation, I will help you. I will keep you and I will make you to be a covenant for the people." There's that covenant again. "To restore the land and to reassign its desolate inheritances." Who said woe? Did you get that? The covenant of the people to restore the land. That's what you're being called to do. In the Hebrew for the word covenant is, and I got it over top there, is berith. In Judges 8:33 and 9:4, it is used as a proper name, Baal berith. This means Baal of the covenant. The Hebrew for man is ish. And if we take the Hebrew word, which means covenant, and the anglicized it, you come up with the Brit-ish people. People of the covenant. Deny these things. You don't have to believe me. Many people don't want to believe. They call it British Israelism. It's not. That's just putting in a box so you don't have to look at it. Look at it. Prove these things wrong. British Israelism, what it actually is a saying that we are superior to everyone else. That is wrong. Remember what I said yesterday? If you are grafted in or native born, it makes no difference. You are an Israelite. But you're not better than everyone else, because he chose the least to make him into the greatest, to show how great he is. The least. Abram was the least of all nations, not the greatest. The people of Wales call themselves in ancient Welsh, Brit-am, which means birth of Britain. This means the covenanters of the land of the covenant. The earliest settlers in Wales and southern England were Simeoni, the descendants of the tribe of Simeon. Are you all aware that if you speak perfect Hebrew, or even if you speak poor Hebrew, you can go to Wales and speak Hebrew and not need an interpreter to speak Welsh? That's the same as speaking, well, Canadian and Texan. Actually, it's more like speaking British England, London England, or one of the suburbs of London, that type of English, and your English, and I can't understand a word that they're saying, but it's English. Or the Bronx, or speaking Australian and South African, that we have people here, try and listen to them. They don't speak English. They speak Aussie. they're even sitting together. We need an interpreter to understand them. What it is, and I'm only kidding, what it is an accent. You know, if I want to speak French, I start to practice my French and English and put the accents wherever the French words would be, and after a while, je parle français, n'est-ce pas très difficile. Yeah. So, it's the accents that makes the difference, where you put the emphasis. So you can speak Hebrew in Wales. And we have a list of words in Wales that match the words in Hebrew and mean the exact same thing. I got goosebumps again. Like, why are we not told this in school? Why is our history only stopped when it comes to the Celtic people? Because I traced my family tree by name to those dates, and then I traced them by tribe to the Celtic tribes. I went right back to when the Celtic tribes came to Britain. And I know where many of the Celtic tribes are. But there's a wall there. They don't want to tell you where the Celtic tribes come from because the Celtic tribes come from the east. So let's stop this line. We're going to stop right here now and we're going to continue down another thread. We're going to rethink our brains. I want to show you something else. Because now we're going to go to Numbers. Numbers in your Bible. And the numbers in your Bible are going to show you things that you haven't seen before. Here's the Shekinah at the tabernacle in the wilderness. Here's the Shekinah on your national crest, your presidential seal. Right? It's right there. No, we can't see that. No, that don't count. That's that Israel, British Israel thing or that Armstrong thing, right? No, we don't count that. Here's another picture of it. Numbers 10, verse 13. Thus they departed the first time according to the command of Yehovah by the hand of Moses. And the banner. Do a word study on the word banner. Do another word study on the word ensign. How many military people are here? How many? What's a banner? What's your ensign? It's the crest of your platoon. It's the crest of whatever division you're in. Okay? What we're going to read here now in Numbers is the crest or the ensign or the banner or the flag, because it's all the same word, over each of the tribes. Thus they departed for the first time according to the command of Jehovah by the hand of Moses. And the banner of the camp of the children of Yehuda departed first according to their divisions. And so you know that they departed in a certain order. And we're going to speed this up a little bit because you know this. They departed in a certain order, but the first was Judah. No, you don't get it. Oh, I got to read it again. And the banner of the camp of the children of Israel departed, of Jehovah departed first according to the divisions and over their army was... No, I missed a verse. Skip wrong verse. Where did it go? Oh, there it is. And the banner of the camp, the first to go, was the children of Judah. What?
Judah is the banner.
No. Who's the first one back in the land?
Judah.
The lion. The lion. Oh, good. Light bulb's going on. Okay. You can read the rest of Numbers 10. The camp was set up in a specific order. Each camp had a banner. Each flag was a representing the tribe. And the head of that tribe were the four symbols, the four leading tribes. Judah, Ephraim, Dan, Reuben. The four corners, the four stations around the camp, around the tabernacle. And what are those four symbols look like? The eagle, the lion, the bull, and the man. Guess what? Guess what? This is a cherub. You read about this in Ezekiel. This is what the cherub looks like. Why? Why? They're always associated with the holiness of Jehovah. When Adam sinned, cherubim were stationed at the entrance of the Garden of Eden to guard the way of the tree of life. They represented the righteous government. They represent the righteous government of Jehovah and are the executors of Jehovah's righteousness and his holy judgment. The cherubs are revealed in Ezekiel in chapters 1, 5 through 10 as four living creatures, each one having four different faces, the face of a man, a lion, an ox, and an eagle. Now, these aren't exactly pictured right, but this is the best picture I could get. So they're quite not quite in the right order. Now, expand that out, and here's the camp of Israel. The camp of Israel was set up with the main or leading tribes as head banners or the head flag, the leading heraldic. You know what? When I say heraldic, you know what I mean. Heraldry, the crest, the emblems. These are the main emblems for each tribe. Notice that they resemble the cherub. Here they are again. Now they're broken down because each tribe was ahead of three tribes on each section, all around the tabernacle. And then you had the Levites around the tabernacle to protect that area so nobody walked in there. And anyone that walked in there, whether animal, beast, or child, was to be shot. Pretty severe. Numbers 2:2, the children of Israel are to camp, each by his own banner, each by his own flag, each by his own ensign, beside the sign of his father's house. Let them camp around the tent of meeting at a distance. And on the east side, towards sunrise, those of the banner of the camp of Yehuda camp according to their divisions. And the leader of the children of Yehuda, Nashon, son, and his army with their registered ones, 74,000. So we can, you know, there's a lot of things. But each camp is designed this way. And this is the way they were to move each time. And guess what? Their nations now are designed similar. Judah's in the east. Right? It's kind of amazing. So now we got to stop that. I'm just, you know, I gave you a little taste there. I got to stop now. I got to go someplace else. Because before the Exodus, something took place. We have other migrations to learn about. We have Moses, who came and took the people out of Israel. But before Moses came, there were other Exodus. And you read in the Humash, however you say it, that 30 years before the Exodus, Ephraim tried to leave on their own because they calculated the 430 years to be 400 years. And they left 30 years early and they got slaughtered by the Philistines on the northern highway into the promised land. Why did Moses take the southern route? Because the northern route, everyone was so afraid of taking because they got killed there before. Just 30 years before. Utterly slaughtered. And Ephraim was devastated. Read that in the footnotes of your Humash. Now, who is Danus and Cadmus? Again, open up your encyclopedia. It says, Encyclopedia Britannica, do not believe the British Israelism, do not believe Armstrongism. Prove this yourself in your own encyclopedia because it's right there. Don't believe me, I'm just Canadian. We already know everything. You guys just haven't figured it out yet. Now the Egyptians say that also after these events, what events is that? The plagues of Exodus. A great number of colonies were spread from Egypt. So I'm taking this right out of the Encyclopedia Britannica. A great number of colonies were spread from Egypt all over the inhabited world. They say also that those who set forth with Dan, Danaus, likewise from Egypt, settled what is practically the oldest city of Greece. Argos, Toronto, Argonauts, Argos. You've heard of Argos? Look up your ancient Greek history. And that the nations of Colchi, C-O-L-C-H-I, in Pontus, and that of the Jews, which lies between Arabia and Syria, were founded as colonies by certain immigrants from their country. So here's an Egyptian record in your Encyclopedia Britannica comparing the people of Argos and other colonies in Greece and comparing to the same Jews that settled in the Eastern Mediterranean. They're the same people. But they're using different names for them, and then people go astray and get lost. And this is the reason why it is a long-established institution among these peoples to circumcise their male children. But that's done away according to the New Testament. That's why these people circumcise their children, because it's a custom that they were taught by Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all 12 sons, taught their sons. That's why Ishmael teaches their sons to do it. Circumcise their male children, the custom having been brought over from Egypt. They were captivity in Egypt. This is where we're talking from. This is before Moses got there. And we got a great story here to tell. Even the Athenians, they say, are colonists from Sais in Egypt. This is the history of Diodorus of Sicily by G.H. Oldfather, Volume 1, Books 1 to 2, 1 to 34, pages 1 to 34, 1933, page 91. I'm not making this up. It's right there in your history books. Hecateus therefore tells us, so this is another historian, that the Egyptians, formerly being troubled by calamities, what's that about? The Exodus. In order that the divine wrath might be averted, expelled all aliens. See, they're trying to cover up that Moses actually took them all out. So we gave him authority to go. No, Moses took them. This is the Exodus. Expelled all aliens, gathered all aliens to... Gathered all. See, I had trouble doing this on the video. It's only one line. I couldn't say it. It took me 30 takes. Expelled all aliens gathered together in Egypt. Of these, some under the leaders of Danaus and Cadmus migrated into Greece. Others into other regions, a greater part into Syria. Syria is what they call Israel today, meaning Palestine. Oh, there's the note there. Their leader is said to have been Moses. A man renowned for wisdom. Who's saying this? Hecateus, an ancient historian. Hecateus. H-E-C-A-T-E-U-S. Look him up. Another author, Mueller, in his work Fragmenta Historicorum Graecorum, which is in Latin, also relates these events as recorded by the pen of Hecateus Abidera. So this is in the 6th century that this is being recorded. That's not British Israelism. This is 6th century. The calamities referred to here are obviously the plagues which Jehovah God brought. Okay, we know that. But here's what most people just skip right over. 2 Chronicles or 1 Chronicles is a boring book. Just names and places and births and... It's the most fascinating book in the Bible. Oh, the whole Bible's fascinating, but this is one of those, well, if you're talking about that subject, it's one of the most fascinating subjects. Here's the sons of Zerah. Who's Zerah? See, when I got mixed up before, it was Tamar. Tamar dressed herself up as a prostitute and attracted Judah to have sex with her. Am I allowed to say sex? Okay. Because Judah did not give Tamar his sons after Tamar's husband died. The children came out. One put out his hand. That was Zerah. Then he pulled his hand back in. But But before he did, the nurse, the midwife, tied a thread around his hand. Pulled his hand back in, and out pops Ferris. And she said, what happened here? How'd that happen? Right? You know the story? So out pops Ferris, and Ferris is a line that goes all the way down to King David to Zedekiah, the last king of the Ferris line. So, the question I ask you, is God a liar? King David shall not lack a king to sit upon his throne. Where's the king? Where's the king of Judah right now? It's not in the state of Israel, but they're thinking of trying to make one. That's going to turn out really, really bad if they do. Zerah stuck out his hand, tied a thread around it, and that symbol of Zerah, I can't tell you yet. But Zerah had five boys. Zimri, Ethan, Hermon, Galkol. Remember, we've already talked about Galkol and Dara. Galkol and Dara are the ones that left Egypt. So there's a scripture there. You can read that. King Solomon in 1 Kings 4:30. Now, this, I never noticed this before. Well, I've noticed it when I was doing the notes, but Solomon's wisdom excelled the wisdom of the children of the East Country and all the wisdom of Egypt. Solomon was the wisest man that ever lived. Chapter 1 Kings 4:31. For he was wiser than all the men, than Ethan the Israelite, and Haman, and Galkol, and Darda, the sons of Mahol, and his fame was in all nations round about. Why did Solomon have to say he was wiser than these five men here? Because these men were full of wisdom and understood prophecy and understood things, and they were brilliant. And they developed all these other nations that came out of there. So here's another list of names. Okay, and we got to pay attention to these names if you want to understand who's who. And his descendants were called Zerahites and Ezrahites and Ezrahites. They have different names, different spellings. Numbers 26:20, 1 Kings 4:31, 1 Chronicles 27:81, and 1 Chronicles 27:11. They all have different spellings for the same name. And it's these names that are passed down through generations. The migrations out of Egypt led Danes and Cadmus and Exodus. So stop here. Stop. What's going on? Why are they leaving? Are they trying to fulfill the commandment that 430 years after you're going to leave? No. Ephraim did that and he got slaughtered. But this was before that. What's going on here? We read in the Bible that Joseph says to his brothers, do not fear. I'm not going to kill you. Right? And I'm going to probably come up to that in a minute, but I got it out of order here, so now I'm guessing what the scripture is. I don't know what the scripture is. The rumor going around the camp is that as soon as Joseph dies, our sons are going to slaughter you and your sons for having caused Joseph all this pain and suffering that he went through when he was thrown into captivity and sold in Egypt. So rather than take the chance, because that rumor is starting to sound true, we're going to get up and leave. So Galkol goes first. Darda goes next. And then Joseph says, do not fear, for what you meant for evil, Yehovah meant for good. And that's the end of it. That's why it happened. And guess what? That history, according to the Sabbatical Jubilee chronology, fits the Encyclopedia Britannica history as to when these countries were first founded in Egypt. To the year. No fudging, no fixing, no adjusting. They got it right in the Encyclopedia Britannica, and it matches the Sabbatical and Jubilee cycles to a T. The migrations out of Egypt led by Danes and Cadmus and Exodus under Moses are not the only ones recorded. Another important Grecian colony was founded by Cecrops, who became the first legendary king of Attica. Cecrops, as we shall see, was an Israelite. And according to the Harmsworth Encyclopedia, not Joe Dumont, the Harmsworth Encyclopedia, Sea Crops, Galcol of 1 Chronicles 2:6, and Chacol of 1 Kings 4:31, and his brother Darda, was the mythical founder of Athens and its first king. He was thought to have been the leader of a band of Hebrew colonists from Egypt. Whoa! The encyclopedia says that? It's right there. So these descendants are called Zarahites. Z-A-R-H-I-T-E-S. Just like my descendants will be called Dumanites. And yours will be called whatever you are. Israelites. Did these bands of Israel refugees stay in Greece and Asia Minor? Or did they migrate further to distant lands across the sea? So now we're going to start to follow these names, because now that we know what they were called when they left Egypt, we can now follow them through history, because history records them. But the thing you just didn't know is what they were called. So we've got the Israelites over here and their symbols that we've already got. Now we're going to follow the Greek people. And then, you know, I don't know if I'm going to come back and do the Israelite ones through Europe. So according to Euripides and the Greek geographer and historian Strabo, these are where the people of Danis and Galcol lived. And these are what they called themselves. The Danai, the Pelia Sigiote, the Pelia Poneas, I can't say these names, Argos, Argives, and Achaia. These are all Israelite tribes. And they're in Greece. Which brings up an interesting prophecy or comment in the New Testament. When I forget who said it, but they're talking about Yeshua, and he says he's going to go where you can't find me. And they're saying, where's he going? Is he going to go to the Greeks? Why didn't they say, is he going to go to the Babylonians? Because the Greeks were their brothers, and they knew it, because they had letters from the Greeks, from Athens to Jerusalem. And Eli, remember Eli, the big fat guy in Judges? He wrote back and said, yeah, you are our brothers. They got this records. Why aren't we taught this? Danis, Darda, Dara, Dardanas, Dardanelles. You were the Dardanelles? Okay, I forgot. You guys are Americans. You don't know anything outside your borders. Canada's to the north. Mexico's to the south. Those are the ones you let in real quick. Canadians you keep out. This is Turkey. Here's the Dardanelles right there. Named after Darda, who founded Troy. Troy is, well, you've heard of the Battle of Troy. When they first left Egypt, they landed in Crete. And they founded all these cities in Crete that have Egyptian or Israelite names. But there was an explosion there. Something bad happened. We don't know exactly what it is. We suspect it might have something to do with the Exodus and the sky turning black for 3 days. Remember the darkness that was so thick? Well, there was a volcanic explosion down here that wiped out a lot of cities around the Aegean Sea. Because it says that Dardis came up to Dardanelle. This is the legend of Troade, with a crippled ship, a crippled fleet of ships, because of some explosion. There's a volcano there that blew up. So here's the symbols from Troy. A serpent. This is a Trojan symbol, a serpent. It's a symbol of Dan. Darda is Dan. Troas. Now, these names that are being shown to you here are names of the descendants of the children. The legends that take place, and these become great legends, and we get great movies out of there. And I'm going to go a little bit faster now, because you guys kind of know the story of Troy and Helena. These are real people. These are Israelite people. And their morality happens. But this is stuff that you can search out and prove to yourself in your own encyclopedia. I love this movie. Because when I watch it, I knew who was who. And I knew who the names were and where they go. One of the names in this character, and this thing is called Perez. Perez. P-A-R-I-S. I don't know where he went, Come on, yes you do. Yeah. This war took place in 1194, 1184 BC, and that lines up with the chronology perfectly. I don't have to fudge stuff here. It just all fits. Achilles, he got shot in the heel. That's where that legend comes from. He killed Hectus. Hectus was the next king of Troy. But this war that they lost in Troy, and all the kings, there were 50 sons of this king, 50 sons who were princes to be king. And they all scattered and became kings in different areas all around the Aegean Sea. But they had this fascination with a horse. Dan and the horse. You go to Ireland, they got white horses sculpted in the hills right now. That's why they took this horse inside, because it's a symbol of something that means something to them. So here comes another little boring stuff. It's family tree history, and it leads you down, you know, who, to what happened, who. And there's some great stuff in here, and I love history. I just love it. But we're almost out of time. So I'm going to go real quick and see where I'm going to end up. I'm trying to get to halfway. I'm not even halfway yet. But you follow the name by name, and each of the kings of Europe are found here. But what's going to get down to is a king in Rome, who is a king of the line of Judah, has a prophecy about this child that's about to be born, and the guy didn't like the prophecy, so he killed the prophet. But the child was said that when he's born, he's going to kill his mother, and he's going to kill his father. That's pretty bad. When he was born, his mother died in childbirth. First part of the prophecy comes true. Later on, when he was practicing, his father showed him how to shoot a bow and arrow. He unfortunately killed his father with the arrow. That child was Brutus. Now, he's a descendant from the line of Judah. His name is Brutus. Brutus has so much history going for him. It's in your encyclopedia. But all these countries here are settled by kings of Judah from the Trojan line. Troy and the 50 kings are descendants from the line of Judah. We're still Judah right now. We haven't started talking about Zerah yet. Here's some of them. And this is the nicknames that became in Latin. Judah is also called Jupiter. We have a god called Jupiter somewhere in mythology. So some of your mythology that we hear has a basis of truth to it and gets perverted somewhere along the line. And that's why you should look at mythology and consider the facts and find out what's relevant and what's not and sort things out. Roma, guess who Roma is? Tamar. Well, I gave you the clue. I can't ask you questions. Give you the answers. Roma is Tamar. So these are the nations right here. This is the Buddha of Italy. And if you search these names, this lineage is right there. From each generation, it's right there. You don't have to go far to find it. It's there. It's in our history books. Continuing down, here's another. So we're getting down to Silvius and Brito. And I'm trying to speed up, so there's so much history here. And Brutus. So now Geoffrey of Monmouth. Does anyone know who Geoffrey of Monmouth is? He's the 8th century historian in England. So this is 8th century history now. He records a Brutus coming to England. And Brutus picked up a bunch of Trojans in all these different countries along the way. And he comes to Paris, and he fights the French, and they drive him back out. And he comes back, and he lands in this place called Ludinium, or Light, or Luz. Luz, London, Ludinium. Now it's called London. Lundium, there we go, thank you. I'm skipping my notes. I'm trying to go a little quicker now because you guys are all looking a little peaked. London. He founds a place in London. In the center of London to this day is the Church of St. Paul, where Brutus founded and placed the stone. And it has this history in it that is so rich. And it's our history. And you check some of these places, and he landed in these places. My family tree comes from Devon and Somerset. And guess what? Yeshua lived in Somerset during those years that he's not in the Bible. How do I know? Because when you go to Somerset, and I got people that live in Somerset that read the newsletter and they tell me about it, there's a place there that talks about Yeshua and all the things he did. There's a little island down here called the Island of Wight. Guess who came there? Joseph of Arimathea, the uncle of Yeshua, uncle of Mary, the great uncle of Yeshua. So when Joseph died, the last known record of Yeshua, he's 12. When Joseph died, he took Yeshua with him and became his stepfather. And those boats that went around the Mediterranean and the Atlantic, it took 3.5 years, they took Yeshua with them. Their first stop was the Isle of Wight for lead. You need lead to make iron for the Roman army. Joseph of Arimathea was a proconsul for Rome. Proconsul for Rome. How could he go to Pilate and not get killed? Because he's a proconsul for Rome, which meant he's the most powerful man in Jerusalem. And he was also on the Sanhedrin. So he had these two things going for him. That's why he could go and claim the body, because he's both a relative, a proconsul, and on the Sanhedrin. But he took Yeshua here, and they have a song in the Isle of Wight, in the tin mines of Joseph. And they have a song about Yeshua. They have stained glass windows with a boy in a boat with Joseph of Arimathea coming to England. The boy, he's got red hair and a red beard and freckles. It's Yeshua. North American Indians got the same legend of a young man coming there to tell them about what's coming. I got calendars from Michigan describing the crucifixion of Yeshua, talking about him coming beforehand and telling him what's going to come, and then pictures of a crucifixion afterwards that the Indians made in Michigan, just outside Sarnia. And the ruins are still there. Here's the St. Paul's. This is where Brutus, first capital, was in Londinium. Here's the stone inside there that describes these things and has all this history with it. And it's all right there, but people don't want to talk about it. So in the British libraries are all these old documents which have this history, and it's there. And these documents have been copied, and they're now online. You can read them. Okay, so I'm going to look a bit quick, but prove this stuff. So then we come to the history. And you can take your history and a direct line from King David down to the King and Queen of England this day. It's there. I can trace my family tree all the way back to Adam and Eve. I have to go by tribes for a few hundred years, but I can do it now. And I wasn't trying to figure all this stuff out to figure out who Israel was. I was just trying to find my family tree. This is the king of England who knew of his Trojan bloodline. It's one of the only kings of England that admitted it. So let's take a break now. Let's go and have lunch and let you guys go and think, is this guy nuts? Or is this stuff really real? And are we really the tribe of Joseph, of the 12 tribes of Israel, and also the ones that bear the name of Israel? Because that's what I'm telling you. So this afternoon, if you show up and come back, I hope you do. I'm still going to be here, and we're going to show you some more things, I hope. And I think it'll go faster because most of it is just pictures. Okay? Thank you. But right now, we left off talking about the Trojan kings and how they are infiltrated throughout all of Europe. Because if you look at the kings and queens of Europe, they're all related. And how did that happen? It happens through the Trojan line. How many of you trace your family tree? Wow. Okay, it says in the Bible you're not to spend time wasting time tracing your ancestry, but I did. Arguing it. You should do that. Find out who you are. It's amazing. Don't make it a religion. Just do it as an interesting thing. And they got computer systems now that all you got to do is punch in your name and it's already done by somebody else. So this is Illyria. Now, this is the part of Europe Asia or the Aegean. And this is one of the places where Joshua chased the Canaanites too. Okay, I'm just in a little. I'm giving you an aside. I got rabbit trails everywhere now. And Joshua chased them here. And one legend that I read, he chased them all the way across to the coast of Portugal, trying to wipe them out. Now, some of those Canaanites, they survived. They lived here, and then they got pushed out by these other tribes moving in here, and they moved up to Northern Europe. And they were called, in Scotland, they were called the Picts. And remember I told you a little bit about Brutus? I'm really off my notes now. Now I'm going off the top of my head. Brutus took them and put them on a boat, took them all and put them on a boat and brought them over to North America. Today, we know them as the Iroquois. You know the Five Finger Lakes in New York? That's where they lived. Brutus brought them here from Europe. Why? To stop the fighting, so because someone's going to get killed. I don't know why I went there, I just did. But there are North American Indians that aren't natural to North America. They came from Europe. But then there's other ones, such as the Cherokee, like I mentioned yesterday, that came from the Middle East, and they got stuck here because King David's empire fell after 586. So anyway, what we're showing you here is we're showing you all the places that the Trojan kings went to. And so I'm trying, and the detail, it's in the details. Everything's in the details, and it's amazing. And what I'm offering to you all, every PowerPoint presentation that I'm showing to you, you only see what I want you to see. But I got notes here that are like my newsletters. If you want the PowerPoints, ask and you'll get them. Okay? And then you can take this and take it to your assembly and share it, whatever you want. You can do this. You can double check. So here's the list of kings from Troy. And it comes down to Antenor. Nope, that doesn't. It comes down to Alexander. So we got two different lines. Exium of the Sumerians. Who are the Sumerians? The Sumerians, we haven't even touched on them yet. They're this other group of tribes over in the, what we now call Turkey. But the Trojans are working with them. Why? They're the same people. Remember, the Trojans come from the Greeks who came out of Egypt. And the Sumerians, I sure hope I didn't cut that part out because I thought I would have covered it by now. We're going to get to the Sumerians, I hope. But I got to go quick. This is Germany. And these are some of the kings of Germany. And we're getting into the Franco kings. The amazing thing about the Frankish kings is that they come from the line of Judah. Again, through the Trojan line. Its kings, all the Frankish kings, all wore long hair. Why? They kept their kingly office until the Pope suggested to the East Franks, the Germans, that they could gain the power over the Moravians by cutting the king's hair. Sound familiar? Why would that cause them a problem? Because the kings were being Nazarites. And when you cut the hair of a Nazarite, like not Samuel. Who? Samson, yes. I'm sorry, there's an echo here. It's amazing. There it is, right there. We got all these Moravian kings with long hair. Why? So that's the story of Troy, and that's really it in a nutshell, and I really didn't give it to you in detail because I know I don't want you to fall asleep on me. See, Robert and I were talking at lunchtime, and he analyzed me pretty good. These are Americans, these are Canadians, these are Australians, these are Kiwis, New Zealanders, and this is their traits. I won't tell you what he said about Americans, because you all still like them. But he said about Canadians that were insecure. And he nailed me right bullseye, because I'm very insecure. I constantly don't think you're really interested. So I need, and what happened last night around the campfire, I needed that reassurance. Because I've been going to Israel, and it's just me and a few people, and we don't talk about this too much, but I show them where the temple was and show them all this other stuff. And I show them a little bit of this, and yeah. But for me to see this number out here again this afternoon, it stuns me. It just stuns me. Anyway, sorry, I'm off again. But I need the reassurance, so I'm glad to see us here. Who are the Spartans? Okay, we sort of went over the Trojans real quick. They are of the tribe of Simeon. They come from Lacedaemonia. Now, if you go to Stephen Collins, write this down, Stephen Collins, 10 Lost Tribes of Israel. That'll take you to his website, and he'll tell you a story. You go to Yair Davidi, Yair Davidy, Brit-am. And they have all this information. It's all there, your whole family tree. Who are the Spartans? The tribal emblem of the Danites was a snake with a serpent in its claw. And Josephus records a letter written by Lacedaemonian Greeks to the Jews in which they expressed their kinship to the Jews, their seal that the tribe of Dan was affixed to the epistle, the eagle with a dragon serpent in its claws. Remember, we already saw that. Jonathan, the high priest of the Jewish nation, see, I said it was Eli, I was wrong. Jonathan, the high priest of the Jewish nation, to the Ephori and the Senate. The Ephori is like the House of Chambers. And the Senate and the people of Lacedaemonia send greeting. When in former times an epistle was brought to Onias, who was then our high priest, concerning the kindred that was between us and you. Lacedaemonia writing to the Jews. A copy of which is here subjoined. We both joyfully received this epistle because we were well satisfied about it from the sacred writings. What sacred writings? From the Torah. They had the Torah. Yet did not we think fit first to begin the claim of this relation to you, the glory which is now given us by you, is a long time since this relation of ours to you hath been renewed. And when we, upon holy and festival days, these Greeks are keeping the holy days, upon holy and festival days offer sacrifices to God, we pray to him for your preservation and victory. You will, therefore, do well yourselves to write to us and send us an account of what you stand in need of from us, since we are all things disposed to act according to your desires. Antiquity of the Jews, 13, 5 and 8. Josephus recorded this letter. How come you're not taught this? Where is that in your history? Remember the symbol of Dan? Serpent in the claw. The Lacedaemonian Greeks are Spartans and they are Danites. But we have some more stuff. We have an interesting event in your Bible. Do you guys recall the story where the incident of the Moabite women? Not Ruth. They're standing there and they're talking about the Moabite woman, and all of a sudden this one Simeonite prince comes in with a Moabite woman, stands in front of these guys, and then takes her to his tent and he's making love to her. And what does Phinehas do? He takes a spear and shoves it through the both of them to stop the plague. Do you realize how big a deal that was? It's only like 3-4 lines in your Bible. This was a huge event. Here are the tribes of Judah, or tribes of Israel, at the first census and the second census. The first census was taken shortly after they left Egypt. The second one now is right after this event. Look at the numbers. Reuben doesn't change. Simeon, who this prince was, changed by 37,000. Gad went down by 5. Judah went down by 2. Issachar went down by, or up by 9. Judah went up by 1 or 2. Issachar went up by 9. Zebulun went up by 3. Manasseh went up by 20. Ephraim went down by 8. Ephraim had the double blessing. Why did they go down by 8? This is over a number of years now. This is almost the 40 years in the wilderness. Why would Ephraim go down by 8? Benjamin went up by 10,000. Dan went up by 1,700. Asher went up by 11,000. Asher went up by 11,000, and Ephraim went down by 8. When you read these numbers, you just go, phoop, keep going, plow through it. I don't know what it means. Naphtali went down by 8,000. But the totals are only down by, when you add them all up, only down by 1,800. So you really don't notice it. But notice the tribe of Simeon. What did I tell you about Simeon? What was his symbol? The sword. Right? Simeon and Levi, the sword and the castle. The key to what happened in Numbers 26 is found in the previous chapter. In Numbers 25, we learn that Phinehas, a Levite, and I just went through this, executed a prince of the chief house among the Simeonites. Okay. I'm from Canada. You're the Americans. We got an Australian tribe over there and a South African tribe. And our leaders, who are we going to pick on? Let's pick on the Americans. So South Africa and Australia and I were having a meeting. You know, there's a problem going on with the Moabite women. So in comes the leader of the Americans and jumps in bed with this Moabite woman right in front of us. And this curse is coming. So we send our South African woman, Anna Marie, and she goes in and sticks a spear through the American. Do you see a problem here with all the rest of you? You'd be up in arms. Because you really didn't think it was that bad, because we're already intermingled a little bit anyway. This was huge. This was huge. And they up and they left. They up and they left. The Bible does not record which tribe suffered the most from that plague. Even if one assumes the Simeonites bore the brunt of the plague, it does not begin to account for the drop in population of approximately 56,000 males of 20 years and older among the tribes which lost populations between the two censuses. Also, Numbers 25:9 records that 24,000 people died in the plague. It does not state that all those slain were males 20 years of age and older. This indicates that 24,000 men, women, and children of all ages died in the plague, and that perhaps 6,000 of that total were males 20 years and older. So where did the rest go? Are you getting a hint yet? You seen this movie? You haven't seen this movie? Spartans. The 300, the mighty 300? Yeah. The mighty 300 that held off the Persian Empire, where? From the tribe of Simeon. That's just an amazing story. Okay, so I'm not going to prove it to you here. I want you to go do some homework. I just want to show you that the numbers in your Bible happen to be real life events in our history, or the Greek history, which is our history as well. But it's an amazing history. Your Bible is alive with history. You need to read it, and don't just read over it. If you don't understand it, go and find the answer. It's amazing. Okay, maybe you don't. I love history. I can't get enough of it. John 7:34, "You shall seek me and shall not find me, and where I am, you cannot come." This is what I mentioned about before. "Then the Jews said among themselves, 'Where is he about to go that we shall not find him? Is he about to go to the dispersion of the Greeks?'" Unless you understand that the Greeks are the Israelite tribes that left before the Exodus, and part of the Simeonite tribe that left during the wandering in the wilderness, and even took other tribes with them, you wouldn't know what this means. And you just read right over it. That's, wow. The Doric is a dialect and a local lingo spoken here in the northeast of Scotland, especially around Aberdeen City in the county of Aberdeenshire. How many Scots are here again? Any Dorians? No Dorians? No Dorian dialect? The Dorians are the Simeonites who migrated from there to the boot of Italy and from the boot of Italy up to this spot here. Okay, that only makes really good sense if you're Scottish and got a door. No wonder I like to fight, right? Again, I'm going fairly quickly here. I'm skipping lots of stuff. Please, if you want these notes. So we got Galkol or sea crops, Attica, which is modern Athens, and this is the city that he founded. And it's in your ancient history books. So, these are the children of who? Zerah. We have Pharez, the one that inherited the birthright and the throne and the crown, coming down to Zedekiah. Zedekiah is killed in 586. That line of the kings is gone. So now what? Well, okay, Northern Irish, where are you, Northern Irish people? Oh, really? I didn't know that. Me too. Okay, three people I like. The rest of you, we're Irish, let's fight. What was the thing about the red hand? Oops, I gave it away. What was the thing about Zerah's thing, the ribbon round, it had a red thread? That became the red hand. The red hand of Northern Ireland is Zerah. And why is the flag of Northern Ireland got a Star of David on it with a crown? Remember the Alav Tav? Remember that? Here's the Tav. It's not a cross. It's not a cross. It's a Tav. It's a letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The red hand of Zerah, it identifies our ancestry. It's a banner. It's the flag that we've always worn on our family. Who knew? Right? Who knew? Northern Ireland. So now, this migration going through Greece and all this stuff. So here's the other deal. So I'm giving it to you quickly. No, I'm not. I'm going to go to this one. And it came to be at the time giving a birth that seed twins were in her womb. Genesis 38:28. And it came to be that when she was giving birth, that one put out his hand, and the midwife took a scarlet thread and bound it on his hand, saying, this one came out first. And it came to be as he drew back in his hand, that see, his brother came out first, and she said, how did you break through? Break through, this breach is upon you. So his name is called Peretz, which becomes Pharez. And afterwards, his brother came out who had the scarlet thread in his hand, and his name was Zerah. And today we call them the red-headed people of Northern Ireland, the troublemakers. Why? Because they're Jewish. And where did they go? To Scotland. So the Scottish people are now the Jewish people. Not all of them, but some. Here's something else. One of the descendants of Cecrops was the name of Gothelus. Gothelus' travels in ancient days are recorded. But because of the... it gets kind of jumbled in there, and he becomes, instead of a lifetime in within 100 years, he seems to live about 500 years. And it gets mixed up. So that's not quite right. So Gothelus is not his actual first name, but it's actually a group of people. Have you heard of the Milesians? Okay, let's see. Have you heard of a millennium? What's a millennium? It's 1,000. So where do we get that word? We get it from Milesians. The Milesians had 1,000 fights. Okay? Remember the Irish and all this. What are the Irish? Notre Dame? Any Notre Dame people here? The fighting Irish. Guess we like to fight. Right? Historical records tell us of the westward migration of descendants of Galcol along the shores of the Mediterranean Sea, establishing Iberia. Iberia is today Spain. Iberia is Hebrew. Iberia. And they trade at trading settlements. One settlement was called Saragossa. How is your Spanish? Saragossa. In the Ebro Valley, in Spain. Let's see if I can see that here. Can you see that? Anybody know where Zaragoza is? It's there. That's why I got the map up there, but I can't see it. From Spain, they continued west as far as Ireland. The Iberians gave their name to Ireland, calling this island Iberni. Have you ever heard of the Ibernia Wells? They're off of Newfoundland. Newfies are from Ireland. I'm half Newf. We're trying to figure out which half, but we're going to figure it out eventually. We're from Ireland. And the abbreviation of Iberni is E-R-N-E, and subsequently Latinized into Hibernia. So this is all from the encyclopedia. It's there. Gothelis went and founded the Iberia Peninsula, Ernia, Hibernia, Ireland. Ireland. When did this take place? Long time BC. When did the Exodus take place? I said 1379. So this took place sometime or before that and around that time. So all these histories that we're seeing are overlapping each other and taking place at the same time and growing. Yehovah is doing something. It's not just one little wee narrow thing in the Bible about a bunch of little Jews that go back and forth. It's a magnificent big thing, a big cloud of stuff, a big cloud of people here and over here and coming here and brought up this way and ending up here. And then they end up over here. The story of Gotha's travels is truly remarkable, showing the hand of Jehovah, God at work as he dispersed his people Israel from Egypt. The Chronicles of Scotland. Have you ever read the Chronicles of Scotland? Why? Have you read the ancient historical chronicles by the magnificent masters 80 of Ireland? It's awesome. It's this big. And it's all from the ancient annals of Ireland. It's awesome. Why do you guys just focus on your American Constitution? Because in a few years, you're not going to be talking about it. Focus on your history, because it tells you who you are, where you've been, and where you're going. So continuing this encyclopedia. For as the old chronicles reveal, there was a Greek called Gothelis, son of Cecrops, Galcol of Athens, otherwise of Argus, king of the Argives, who left his native country of Greece and came to Egypt with a strong company of goodly young men. At this time there reigned in Egypt Pharaoh, the scourge of the people of Israel. I'm not reading out of the Bible. This is an encyclopedia talking about a historical document. What did I say it was? Where did I say it? What is it? The Chronicles of Scotland. How's your Scottish accent? Mine's terrible. You guys don't want to give it up because you're all stubborn. Yeah, stiff-necked Israelites, I know he is. And he came, and there's the scourge of the people of Israel, whose son, followed in his father's iniquities, was drowned in the Red Sea. The Chronicles of Scotland. with all his army. The king Pharaoh received Gothlis openly because he, Gothlis, appeared to support the Pharaoh against the Ethiopians and the people of Midian. Where's Midian? On the other side. It's called Saudi Arabia today. Then Pharaoh, with the support of the Gothlis, won a fierce battle against the Ethiopians and brought them so close to defeat that Gothlis took their principal city called Meroe. Gothlis, after this great victory, returned to Egypt and was made general lieutenant over all of Pharaoh's army soon after because he was of the royal bloodline of Greece. What's that royal bloodline of Greece? It's the royal bloodline of Judah through the line of Zerah. King Pharaoh gave him his daughter called Skota. Now that's another different story. That's another version. So here I'm saying the same thing here. I'm skipping my notes. Another version of the story goes like this. So we got different historical records here. So I just read you one from the Scottish Annals. Now we're going to get into the McGeehan Family Society newsletter. So this is another Scottish history on this stuff. One of the most memorable chapters in history is the Celtic race. Celtic race? Are you all Celtics? That's as far back as I could trace. Now we can figure out who these people are. The Celtic race deals with Niall, N-I-U-L, or Neil, pronounced today, youngest son of Phineas, Pharsus, king of Scythia. Who's Scythia? We haven't even got there yet. King of Scythia. So the king of Scythia is over here in what is today called Iran and the Caucasian Mountains, the Caucasus. Niall was reputed to have mastered all the languages of the then known world. The fame of his learning. Remember, the children of Zerah were the wisest of all, and Solomon was even wiser than them. It's amazing that had to be mentioned in the Bible. Because here's this guy who knows every language in the world. The fame of his learning and wisdom spread worldwide. King Faron, probably a corruption of Pharaoh, the first-style Pharaoh Singris of Egypt, invited him to Egypt to instruct Egyptian youth in the sciences. The king gave Niall a large fiefdom on the Red Sea and gave him also his daughter Skota in marriage. Different version. So here's another version by Keating. Melide of the Milesians. Where do we get the Milesians from? 1,000 battles. 1,000 fights. 1,000 wars. Melide, again seemingly the same as Gothlis, befriended Moses and the Israelites. Pharaoh in Tur, supposed son of Nictonibus and the Egyptian, in time remembered their old grudge to the descendants of Neil and the family of Gadel. Now here's an interesting word. Gadel is another word for Gothlis. Gadel. No Irish Gaelic people here? Oh. Namely, their resentment for the friendship the latter had formed with the children of Israel. They then made war upon the Gaels. So now they're called Gaels from Gadel, who is Gothlis, who were thereby compelled to expel themselves from Egypt. A few years after this, the Pharaoh died, and his son Bacchus, Pharaoh, received the crown of Egypt, and he oppressed the people of Israel with a worse slavery than did his father. Therefore, no hope of liberty appeared to the people of Israel until Moses returned from Midian, where he was banished to show the commands of God to the Bacchus Pharaoh. Where am I getting this from? This isn't the Bible. This is history. And it's not American history. Look in your encyclopedias. It's there. And I just got this off the internet in Encyclopedia Britannica. Following this, Egypt was punished with strange plagues because they held the prophecy of Moses in contempt. Gothlis, concerned by the present plague, that was the terrible response of God, resolved to leave Egypt for another abode. A short time afterwards, he provisioned a ship and sailed out of the mouth of the river of Nile with his wife, friend, and servants, Greeks and Egyptians, for fear of the plagues of God. After a dangerous voyage on the Mediterranean Sea, Gothlis landed in a part of Spain called Lusitania, which is afterwards called, Lusitania is also called, what? Okay, now you're getting there, you're getting close. It's called Portugal. That is the port of Gothelus, or the port of Gothel. Right up here is a port. And this is the port of Gothel. This is, as you know, is Portugal. But up here was the port of Gaul. And that's where he landed. And he began to have a war with the Spanish in here. But the Spanish being too numerous, he leaves. But his name remains there. There we go. There's a better picture there. You see it there? The port of Gaul, the port of Gothelus, which is now called Portugal. So according to Irish and Scottish medieval tradition, Goido Glas, Latinized as Gothelas, is the creator of Goidelic languages and the eponymous ancestor of the Gaels. Do you understand what I just said? Do you get that? Okay. These are Americans, Joe. Go simple. Okay, you guys are going to kill me after. And you just don't like... Come on, relax, chill. I'm just having fun with you. Okay, you guys are going to pick on me later, like you did last night, right? Okay. Gothelus comes from the Egyptian sea crops, right? Which was from the tribe of Zerah, which is of the tribe of Judah, and he left before the Exodus. He left before Joseph died. They have this language, and it becomes known as the Gothelic language, or Gothelus language, which is now called Gaelic. Ah, now you're getting it. Okay, yeah, they are Americans. Okay, now they're laughing. Okay, so now, remember I said before that if you speak Gaelic, you can talk to a Hebrew and not need a translator. Because it's the same language. This is how it happened. In Wales, they still speak Gaelic now. You don't need a Hebrew translator to talk to them. The difference is the accent. Right? We got some different accents here. Kentucky and Tennessee. Australia, South Africa. And we're the only ones in Canada that speak English right. If you talk to someone from Britain, it's hard to understand them, but they're speaking proper English. Right? About. How do you say that? Anyways, here's an explanation following through a genealogical family tree chart. Milispan is the Milesians, and it became Hispania. All these little things, and you can get this from the historical map, the four masters of the Chronicles of Ireland. In Irish origin legends, Melispain, or Melispani, later pseudo-Latinized as Melisius, also Milid and Maled, is the ancestor of the final inhabitants of Ireland, the sons of Mil, the Milesians, who represent the vast majority of the Irish Gaelics. His father was Bile, son of Berogan. Mil is very much the product of Latin Christian scholarship. His name is an Irish version of Latin Milis Hispani, meaning soldier of Hispania, which is attested in the passage, and I don't know what that means, in the 9th century pseudo-historical historian Britannium. So there's a history of Britain called Britannum, the history of the Britons. The work offers an account of how Ireland was successfully taken by settlers from Iberia, which was Spain. Among them, Partholam Nemeth and the three sons of Hispanic soldier, the Tres Finit Militis Hispani. As A.G. Van Hamel, okay, we're getting into a lot of details here, but Spanish people came to Ireland. And I met a man who is as Irish can be. He is my neighbor. And he looked like a Portuguese person. And he had no Portuguese ancestry in him. But this is our history. It's following us. So in Northern Ireland, we have the Ulster Scots. What are the Scots doing there? I thought the Irish were the red hand. But they are. And then they moved to Scotland because of this marriage of Scota, who, by the way, was Jeremiah bringing her with Barak, his scribe. You've heard that story? Really? Some yes, no? Okay, 586 BC, Zedekiah is killed. Jeremiah is thrown in the well. And all of Zedekiah's sons are killed before they put out his eyes, right in front of him. No more lineage of Zedekiah. Jeremiah is taken out of the well, and he ends up with, and you read it in your Bible, with the daughters of the king, more than one. And they bring him down to Egypt. And they land in the city that's called to this day something, and I forgot, the effect of the king's daughter city. It's on the Egyptian border with Israel now. And that city was protected by these Egyptian persons. What's Jehovah doing? He's protecting the king's daughter with Israelites from Greece. It's amazing. And then they sail up to Spain, and then they go to Portugal, and then they go up to Ibernia, and they land in Ireland. They land in Northern Ireland. And they marry into the kingly line that was already there. And they change the name from Gallus to Scotus in honor of this queen, this princess of Zedekiah. And she was such a noble queen. So they called everyone Scots after her. And the Scots are in Northern Ireland. But the Scots move. And see the yellow green areas? They go from Northern Ireland, the green area, to the green area of Scotland. And it's when they crossed over that sea that they got the Scottish accent. And this is where the Dorians kick in, because they got a Dorian language here. The Scots historically are intruders. They came from Ireland and built the kingdom of Dalriada on land which had once been Pictish. Remember I told you about the Picts being taken up by Brutus? In the west of Scotland, in Argyll and the Isles. By the mid-6th century, they held a sizable kingdom lying north of the Britons on Strathclyde and stretching up beyond the Great Glen, and they named it after the district of Ulster. The Scottish named this after the district of Ulster, from which they took their royal house. The History of Scotland by Rosalind Mission. The oldest Irish chronicles reveal that Abbot Tighearnach, a descendant of the Scottish kings of Ulster, led a colony of Milesian Scots from Antrim, which is my hometown, from Antrim in Northern Ireland to the northernmost parts of England. After defeating the Picts in a number of battles, they gained complete control of this area and also named it in honor of Scota, Scotland, the land of the Scots. Who are we talking about here? The Red Hand, remember, of Northern Ireland. So what do? They're Jewish. What's their symbol? The lion. So instead of it being a golden royal lion, they make it the red lion. This is the symbol of Scotland. It's a banner identifying who they are, going right back to Zerah, the son of Judah. Those Scots migrated again. They came to what we call New Scotia, Nova Scotia in Canada. They're a hard-headed bunch of people. There's the flag of Judah in Israel. It's there right now this day, a blue lion. There's the flag of Scotland, a red lion. There's the crest of the King and Queen of England. And there's the royal standard in the middle there with the three lions in it. And Ireland and Scotland are in the crest. Your heraldry tells you who you are and identifies your way back home. Here's a royal lion from the Czech Republic. Which? This one? So here's one that has this emblem on her family. Here's the coat of arms of the former kingdom of Bohemia, another lion. I don't know where this one's from. Just landed on my sheet here. I love this place. I love this place. Here's Lyon, Spain. Norway. Holland. Oops. Yeah, Norway's got the battle axe. What do you see there in Holland? The symbol of the sword. Right there. Right? Everything that you see in here, and notice that the Dutch don't have a crown on it. Interesting. Now the Scottish have taken the crown off. Why? Because the crown got passed on to England in 1300 by Longshanks, another one of my ancestors. Yeah, I come from a group of bad people. Right? Yeah, well. Here's Northern Ireland, another coat of arms. Notice the red hand, the red line on the side. But you notice that none of these animals are chained down like the unicorn is. Here's Belgium. Remember Belgium? I'm telling you, all these countries that are part of the tribes of Israel. Okay, remember what I said about Belgium, the royal chalice? You can see it up there in the end of these little sticks or staffs that they have there. Macedonia, 1595. Denmark, whoops, here's the three lions. The three lions of Judah with royal crowns on. Here's the royal arms of England. Wales. So what we've now looked at is ancient history that took place before and during and after the Exodus in 1379 BC. We got one more thing to do now. We got to look at it in relative history. Because this is the one you're all familiar with, but you haven't connected the dots. And all I do is connect the dots. That's the favorite thing I used to do on my drive down the floor, played connect the dots. The great nation of Assyria began to have contact with Israel at the Battle of Karkar. Remember I talked about the Battle of Karkar? 853 BC is one of those benchmark years. It was 734, 732 BC. Now see, here's another little thing. Keep in mind here, when this started, who invited Assyria to come and fight Israel? Judah. Judah. Why? Because Assyria was giving Judah a hard time. Who sold Joseph into slavery? Judah. What's about to happen in the future? The Americans are going to double cross on the Jews and Welch, and the Jews are going to go for help in Europe. And the Americans are going to be left hanging. But here is the depiction of Judah or of Israel being captured, of Judah being captured, Zedekiah. This is a black obelisk. I mean, this is Yehu. Okay, this is Shalmaneser III, records of victory over Ahab's successors Yehu in 841 BC. Another record of Israel's defeat, recorded by the Assyrians. The Assyrians, and this is an important record, because the Assyrians would call the house of Omri, and you need to pay attention to this part, because this is, you know, all the rest of that's interesting, but this part is important. The house of Omri was called by the Assyrians because they couldn't say Omri, because they're Assyrian. They pronounced the Bet Kumri, Kumri, the house of Omri. So they said the house of Kumri. Remember, accents play into this. They change how words look like. Bit Kumri. In 745, we have on record that Tiglath-Pileser carried away Asher, Issachar, and Zebulun and built cities for them called Zaka, Danaim, Elisana, Abriana, Evesa, and these are Israelite names for the people of that Tekleth had conquered. And those cities are recorded in your Bible. In 731-732 BC, another part of the nation of Israel was led away as captives. 1 Chronicles 5:26. So the Elam of Israel stirred up the spirit of Pul, sovereign of Asher, even the spirit of Tiglath-Pileser, sovereign of Asher, and he took the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, okay, remember Manasseh, into exile and brought them to Hala and Harbor and Hara and the river of Gozan unto this day. So there's a map of where they were taken. Right here, Gozan, and there's the river. And Hala over here. In 723 BC, the rest of the nation of Israel was led away captive. What I want you to notice is the Medai right here, who are the Medes and the Persians that are already taken form. Here's the Persians down here, but they're up here in truth. 2 Kings 17:6, in the ninth year, Hosea, sovereign of Asher, captured Shamron and exiled Israel to Assyria and settled them in Hala, Harbor, and the river of Gozan. So the same cities they had been settled in before. The cities of the Medes. From the royal letters dated to 708-707 BC, we have the Israelites being called Gamera, because they were living in the land of Gamer. These letters to the king of Assyria also identify these Israelites who had been placed there south of Lake Ermaya. This place where the Israelites had lived, called Gamer, meant that the Israelites were then called Gamerans. Gamerans. We can also easily deduce the name of Gamer is from the name of Qumri. Remember Bit Qumri? Bit Qumri becomes Gamer. From the royal letters dated 679 BC, Esarhaddon wrote prayers to the god of Semeseking for advice about the Gamerians and also the Iskusa, who were attacking their forces on the borders of the Medes. Where were the Israelites? In amongst the Medes. Some of the Israelites were placed in the land of the Medes, as we've showed you before. So Iskusa is from the word Isaac. And it means Isaac. So we're no longer looking for Israelites, we're looking for Iskusa or Iskusaites and Gameraites. That's what you should be looking for in your history books to find out who and where the tribes went. The house of Israel is already calling themselves the house of Isaac before the captivity, because we read it here in Amos, and now we see that they are also called Iskusa, a form of the same name. You see there, they call themselves Isaac, the house of Isaac. The Iskusa were called Shuthe, however you want to pronounce that. See, I can't even say these names, and that's the problem with going to different languages. The records of our ancestry is recorded by people that did not speak Hebrew. They spoke Assyrian. And then after that, they spoke Babylonian. And after that, they spoke Persian, and they spoke Mede. And those are the records that we have. And then they spoke Greek. And these records all change the way you pronounce the names. But they're called Saka by the Persians, which means Isaac. Herodias, who is a Greek, tells us that the Persians called the Sakae Scythians. Now you have another known family in history. So did the ancient Greeks. Another name of them was the Sakae. Even the Chinese recognized this people, calling them the Se. Chinese imperial records and even Greek history claim that the Sakasina, originally Scythians, were pushed west and displaced by the Asian tribes. So right now, I've just shown you different nations around the world are recording the Israelite tribes of Isaac by the name of Scythia, Issachar, or something to that version. After the reign of Sargon II, so now we're moving down our chronology, Sargon II, 721 to 701 BC. Remember, they went into captivity in 723. So this is only 20 years. Is that going right? Yeah, 20 years. The name Qumri or Qumri is not mentioned by the Assyrian kings anymore. This is when the Gemara become Gimera and are recorded by the Assyrians as living among the Mene. Remember the Mene, I showed you on the map, is the Medes. A few miles from the Medes. As we've seen, the names Gemer, Gemara, and Gemara are corruptions of Qumri or Qumri. Now, you guys say this stuff. Say these words and pronounce it. Don't just say it yourself. How would you say these words? How do they sound when you say them? Because that's what this is. It's a lesson in phonics. Due to the Assyrian language, and these are all names for the Israelites that the Assyrians took into captivity. The Iskusa, Sake, Saka, Scythians are derived from the Issachar, or the house of Isaac. The Assyrians' name, Gimera'an, is translated into, and that's a hard C, Gimera'an. Isn't that so simple? Now we've just identified where they went, and all we've done now is go 23 years in history. Okay, I see in some ahas going on, the lights, people are falling asleep, but the others are awake. I see it. The Assyrians of the time of Esarhaddon, record campaigning against a people they call the Akkadian, in the Akkadian, the Ashkusa, or the Ishkusa. It is a record by the Assyrians in the second year of Esarhaddon, 679 BC. So 723 to 679 BC is what? 50 years. How long is 50? That's World War I or II. That's not that long ago. That the Gemara had risen in rebellion and the Assyrian army pursued and defeated them in the upper Euphrates district. But a large number of Israelites, the Gemara, escaped to the shores of the Black Sea. Now they're migrating. Where after 600 BC, the Lydian king, remember the Lydian king? We talked, that's one of the Trojan kings. Aliates drove them out of Asia Minor, but this time the Greek called these Gemarans Kimmeroi. Kimmeroi. Say it, Kimmeroi. Translated into English as Kimmerians. The C is a hard K. The single greatest proof that the Saka, Iskusa, Gemara, Kimmerians, and whatever other spelling of the name that was used are all the same people comes from the Behistun rock in Iran. Everyone who knows about the Bible knows about King Darius, who ascended to the Persian throne in 521 BC, 200 years after the 10 northern and most of the rest of the tribes of Israel had been taken into captivity. In Daniel 5:30, Darius the Mede, who was the king who took over after Belshazzar, the Chaldean king, was slain. Darius is the king who put Daniel in the lion's den in Daniel chapter 8. But that's about all biblical students know about this King Darius. What you probably don't know is that during the first 6 years of the reign of King Darius, his army had put down rebellions in various parts of the empire. This included portions of the Scythians, which we now know were those 10 tribes of Israel. They have never been lost until the 19th century. They have never been lost until the 19th century. That's when they became lost. They are recorded throughout history. You just don't know what they're called. This is British Israelism. No, it's not. This is biblical history that you can find in any Encyclopedia Britannica once you know what the names are. Do not let somebody blackball this by calling it something that it's not, making it sound bad. Darius recorded taking some Sakas, S-A-K-K-A-S, prisoners. This record was inscribed on a stone face and forms an important Israelite-Scythian archaeological link that no one can deny. And because of its location, no one can destroy it. This is in Iran today. The inscriptions are in three languages, Babylonian, Akkadian, Elamite, which is Susian, and Persian. They are chiefly in the cuneiform and wedge-like characters. A young English officer in the Persian army, Henry C. Rawlinson, is given credit for successfully deciphering the old Persian signs. Each language records the exact same event. The inscription is like the Rosetta Stone of Egyptian hieroglyphs. Once the first language is deciphered, the rest came after. The dormant features of the Behistun rock inscriptions is King Darius in royal attire and surrounded by captives. Around the captives are the five main panels, 20 in all. The first panel contains 19 paragraphs, and I'm going into detail here because this is important. Listen and understand. 19 paragraphs and 96 lines. Each paragraph commences with the words, "I am Darius, the King of Kings, the King of Persia." The second panel has 16 paragraphs and 96 lines. Over each figure is a brief history of the man in the tribe he represents. The inscriptions include a list of 23 nations over whom Darius ruled, and named among these are the Sakkas, S-A-K-K-A-S. In both the Persian and Elamite versions of the original word is Sakka, S-A-K-K-A. But in Babylonian version, the same people are called Gimera, G-I-M-I-R-I. This is indisputable proof that the Assyrian and Babylonians called the Israelite exiles Gemera, regardless of where they lived. It also proves that a branch of the Gemera called Sakka by the Persians had migrated a long way and lived on the eastern edge of the Persian Empire. The eastern edge of the Persian Empire is entering into the Chinese, what we call the Chinese territory today. Look at a map of Iran. So, more proof, and this is where you guys should get excited. Just in case you still need it, the Sakka were a branch of the Gemera, and therefore the original tribes of Israel is provided by another trilingual transcription found at the tomb of Darius in southwestern Persia. This tomb is cut into the face of the cliff of the valley of near the ancient city of Persepolis. Again, the inscription includes a list of the nations over which Darius ruled. This time, he lists three separate groups of people, groups of the Sakkas. King Darius says, "By the favor of Ahuramazda, these are the countries which I seized out of Persia. I ruled over them, they bore tribute to me, and they did what was said to them by me. They held my law firmly, Media, Elam, Parthia, Arya, Bactria, Sogdia, Chorasmia, Drangiana, I should have these up there for you to read, Arachosia, Satagadia, Gandhara, India, and the Hyoma drinking Scythians, the Amerigian Sakkas, the Scythians, Sakka, with pointed caps." Who are the Scythians with pointed caps? We call them Tooks in Canada now, right? Tooks. We don't call them Tooks? Am I not allowed to say Tooks? Man, Tooks, they're Tooks. They're like pointed hats, winter hats. So, the Heoma drinking Scythians. What was one of the things about Joseph in his prophecies? They're drunkards. Right? Joseph, Ephraim, the drunkards of Ephraim. Here it is. It's been recorded for you in history. I don't know what Heoma is, but I think it's a drink. Now, these particular drunkards were called Amerigians. Okay, no one's getting an aha moment. Okay, let's carry on. You guys, okay, let's carry on. No, hold on. Let's carry on because the aha's coming. The Scythian sacca with pointed cap. So there it is, a picture of a Scythian with a pointed cap. That's an Israelite. That's a Canadian Israelite. We still wear those toques today. The American sacca is an early version of the word American. Do you see how they're connected? Say the top word to yourself. Say it out loud, just so you can whisper it. American. American. Manasseh. Let's go a little bit back. We got to show this to you a little bit better than that. Like I said, I don't just prove it. I try and prove it four different ways if I can. Manasseh. One of the sons of Manasseh was called Makir. Makir is also equal to, in other pronounces, Merakada. Merakanda. Do you see Canada in the last part of that name? Merakanda. Maruka. And Amerigio. I don't even know how to say that. So when you have an Amerigio, what do you have? Mercia is also another way of saying the same son of Makir. Is known to, on the continent of Meringus, the land of Makir of America. Makir is America. It's a son of Manasseh. Okay, I got goosebumps. I don't know about you, but that, wow. Makir equals Markada, Makanda, Maruka, Amerigi, all of the East Caspian Sea. That's where they lived, all of the east side of the Caspian Sea. Makran, southern Iran, and Skati and Maraka were names given to the Mercians, means Scyths from Maruka, east of the Caspian Sea. Mercia, known on the continent as Meringus, important element among the Goths. Remember the Goths? The Meringas were important among the Goths. And Anglo-Saxons. Marcomanni is another name for them in Germany. The name of Makir, son of Manasseh, became, after a simple letter permutation, the name America, which therefore may be understood as meaning the land of Makir. You can find this on Yair Davidi's Brit-am site. Yair Davidi is an Orthodox Jew. He does not believe in Christianity. And he's done this as a Jew to find out where the 10 lost tribes went. This is his information. You know, it's right there. With Israel gone, all that was left after 723 BC was the southern kingdom of Judah. And they too were taken into captivity. And there's where they were taken. And notice again that the area that they were taken of was Babylon. I also want you to notice that one of the main things that Assyria and Babylon do is when they beat you in a war, they transport you to another place so that you become disoriented and can't organize against them. Important piece of information, because it continues to be done today by key nations. And we'll be talking about that tomorrow. And again, I'm going to use heraldry to prove to you who they are. How can you guys see that? So here's Israel from the second captivity. Here's Israel from the first captivity. Here's the Caspian Sea. This is Media. So I think this is Iran now. Here's Afghanistan way over here. This is the area of Iraq. And then Syria is over there. That's the area that they were. Now, when you start looking in your books, you'll start to see that their names are now being reflected in history as the Gemarians or the Kimmerians. And we haven't got a little bit, we've got to go a little bit further yet. So they're all in Iran, which I just showed you, and Iraq. And right here, or up here a little bit, is the Caucasus Mountains. Why is that important? Because the Persians, or the Medes and the Persians, you know, the same as they are today. They don't really take prisoners, and they just kill you. So they started killing and executing the royalty of the Israelite lines. So they started to flee, but they couldn't flee this way because they were cut off. There was a tribe over here, and that's another great story, but they had to go around. There was a tribe here that came down to India and then went over here and then back around. And they became known as the White, Genghis Khan, the White Huns. The White Huns, that's Naphtali. But the majority of them are trapped right here by this wave of Medes and Persians. And I might be getting ahead of myself. No, I'm not. I'm right on. And they're going to go up this way. And I don't know why they didn't go that way, but here is Armenia. And that's where the royal line was held. Here's the Caucasus Mountains. You can't go through it. It's a barrier, and we're going to get slaughtered if we don't find a way to go through. But there's a pass right here, I think it is. And it's called the Pass of Israel. Wow. Do you ever wonder where you get the name Caucasian from? Instead of just being called white people, we're called Caucasians. Because we had to pass through the Caucasus Mountains, and we lived on this side of them. This powerful and increasingly numerous people therefore spread further north, both east and west of the Caspian Sea. To the west of it, they penetrated into the Volga and Don River valleys. The Don River, that's a clue. It's named after Dan. And they were called now the Sarmatians and the Royal Scyths. The Royal Scyths, nomadic people. To reach these lands, they had come up through the Caucasus Mountains by a great pass, which is today occupied the Georgian military road. Perhaps economists have changed the name of the pass in recent years, but from ancient times until within our own lifetime, the pass was known as the Pass of Israel. The white race of Europe is also known as Caucasian because the ancestors of many of them did thus come out of the Caucasus Mountains. And to travel through the Caucasus Mountains, taking the route by the Georgian Road, this is one of the two highways through the mountains from south to north. Do you know when Israel crossed the Red Sea, it parted? Yeah, you know that. When Israel crossed the Jordan, it parted. Are you aware that when they went through the Caucasus Mountain, the river, the raging river there, stopped and parted so they could go across? Where is it in our history books? But it's there in our history. Why don't we know this? While Nebuchadnezzar was attacking Jerusalem and taking the southern tribes of Judah and Benjamin, known as the House of Judah, into Babylonian exile in 604 and 586 BC, the western branch of the northern 10 tribes, now known as the Cimmerians with a hard C, C-I-M-M-E-R-I-A-N, were migrating up what is now the River Danube. That's that blue line. They arrived near its source in southern Germany around 600 to 500 BC, where they became known as the Celts, with a hard K, C. Or they're also called Gaul, after Gothelus. Remember Gothelus? Gaul, Gaelic? Among the tribes of Scythia, the Massagetae attracted the notice of all ancient historians. By their number and warlike ability, those who describe them in more detail divide them into the Massagetae and the Thisengetae. The Getae, part of the name, soon evolved into Goth. The Massagetae were the greater Goths, and the Thisengetae were the lesser Goths. Thus, we already find among the Scythians names we can identify as the peoples who later conducted the great migration into Europe. The Goths, as we know, were later called Ostrogoths, meaning the East Goths, and the Visigoths, meaning the West Goths. So this is history that now is starting to become relevant to you because you understand it. We have seen that the names of the Mesengedi and the Thesengedi evolved into Goths and Ostrogoths, or East Goths and Visigoths and West Goths. I'm talking fast, I'm sorry. The historian Ptolemy, remember I told you about Ptolemy? He recorded history from about from the Babylonian kings down to our modern time, who died in 150 AD, mentions a Scythian people descended from Sakai by the name of Saxons, who had come from Media. Albinus, who lived in the first century BC, also says, now Albinus is another historian who lived in the first century BC, the Saxons were descended from the ancient Saka of Asia, and in process of time, they came to be called Saxons. Predu, another historian, reports that the Kimbrians came from between the Black and Caspian Sea, and that with them came the Angli, A-N-G-L-Y. Ironically, so here's the great story I started to tell. Ironically, it was Cyrus, king of Persia, who made the decree that let the house of Judah return to Jerusalem and rebuild. Yet, in 530, he marched north to bring under his control the rule and rule the main body of Israelite exiles, now known as Iskusa, or the Scythians, who were living south of the Caucasus Mountains. In a fierce battle with the Scythians under their local queen, Tomyris, the Persians were defeated and Cyrus was taken captive and killed. God had his judgment and Israelites had theirs. Tomyris took the head of Cyrus and filled it full of blood because she said she will quench his thirst for blood. And that's what she did. And she's one of the great history queens of our nations and we don't know hardly anything about her. So I got to hurry up. So here we have the migrations of Israel. And you see, some of you must have seen this stuff like this, but this is all recorded in history and now can now be proven. These are some of the migrations of the Jewish diaspora afterwards. Now I want to show you this. The Scottish Declaration of Independence. In the Arbroath Abbey, following the removal of the Stone of Destiny, which we talked about before, to Westminster, King Robert the Bruce, so this is after the King of England defeated the Scots, King Robert the Bruce of Scotland was visited by two emissaries of Pope John XXII, to whom Edward II of England had appealed for help to compel Scotland to acknowledge England's lordship. You know, the stubborn Scots wouldn't give in. These emissaries bore a message from the Pope advising Bruce to submit to Edward's claims. But Bruce and his nobles drafted a letter which they addressed to Pope John XXII and which can still be seen in the Registered House of Edinburgh. It had attached to it colored ribbons and seals with the signatures of Robert the Bruce and 25 of his nobles. So this isn't just one man's opinion. It's all of Scotland understood this. The letter, which is drafted April 6, 1320 AD, read in part, "We know, most holy Father and Lord," okay, so they got some little, this is talking to the Pope, "and from the chronicles and books of the ancients gather that among other illustrious nations, ours," speaking of Scotland, "to wit the nations of the Scots, has been distinguished by many honors, which passing from the greater Scythia through the Mediterranean Sea and the pillars of Hercules," okay, the pillars of Hercules, Gibraltar, "and sojourning in Spain, Iberia, Hibernia, the Hebrew land, among most savage tribes, through a long course of time, could nowhere be subjugated by any people, however barbarous. And coming thence 1,200 years after the outgoing of the people of Israel." Why would the King of Scotland be talking about the people of Israel except that he was a descendant of them? They by many victories and infinite toil acquired for themselves the possessions of the West which they now hold. In their kingdom 113 kings of their own royal stock, no stranger intervening, have reigned. For so long as 100 of us are left alive, we will yield in no least way to the English domination. We fight not for glory nor for wealth, nor honor, but only and alone for freedom, which no man surrenders but with his life. Powerful words. Freedom is what we all talk about in Israel. So, I got so much more here to go, but I'm going to stop here. I think I've made my point. Your ancestry is right there. You, Amerigiae, the Amerigians, that's your ancestry, the son of Makur. That's you. Don't let nobody buffalo you into thinking that it's a bad thing to be a descendant of Israel. But don't let nobody also confuse you in thinking that you are superior to anyone else. You're not. But because you are Israel, everything that I'm teaching you this week is because you are Israel. You, America, are Israel. You, Canada, are Israel. You, Australia, are Israel. You, England, you, New Zealand, you, South Africa, are a part of Israel. And because you are part of Israel, and we keep repeating that covenant word all throughout this teaching, we have broken the covenant that our ancestors made at Mount Sinai. Again, look on the nightly news. You are suffering the plagues of Leviticus 26, starting verse 14, for not keeping the covenant. Because you are Israel, not because it's happens chance, not because it's circumstances or just a coincidence, it's because you are Israel and because he's calling you back to keep his Torah. And if you don't want to keep it, then you pay the price for not break or for breaking the covenant. But if you do want to keep it, if you do want to repent and you do want to keep the Sabbath and the holy days and the sabbatical years, then Yeshua has already paid that price for you. But you got to repent. And I told you the story about me repenting, and then I was shown this stuff, and then I did tested, and then I took that test, and I accepted, and I passed the test, and then I was shown the sabbatical and jubilee cycles. You, sons of Makur, you, sons of Gimer, you, the sons of Manasseh and Ephraim, if you don't repent, there's going to be hardly any of his left in just a few years. So, why is this important? Because we're talking about you, Israel. It's not some Jews over there, it's you. The Judah didn't get the name Israel, which we showed you today. You did. That's why you're the greatest nation in the world, because you received all the blessings from Jehovah. For all the greatness, it's not because you're better than anyone else, it's because he blessed you in spite of yourselves. You received these blessings. And you are now going to have them all taken away from you. I do this so you know who you are. Because if you don't know who you are, you don't know what the Bible's talking about, you don't know Bible prophecy, and if you don't know sabbatical and jubilee years, you can't understand Bible prophecy. And I'm teaching you both now. I have to go through some basic stuff right now because I know that you are Makur, your sons of Israel, and you're thick and slow to learn. I'm going to have a lot of fun tonight sitting around the campfire all by myself. Right? Israel has been chained up. That's what that chain represents. And Judah repented, went back. Remember Nehemiah? They locked up the doors because people in Judah still wanted to work and sell and buy on the Sabbath. But from Nehemiah 4:8-18 on down, we have records of the sabbatical and jubilee years until the Bar Kokhba revolt. And after that, they're kicked out of the land again. Repent from not keeping the sabbatical years. Tomorrow, I'm going to show you who your enemy is. It's Assyria. It's the same enemy we've had since the beginning. And I'm going to show you through heraldry. And I hope it doesn't take this long, because I still got 60 more slides to go here. but we're going to shut her down. You are the sons of Makur. Amakur, American. The sons of Manasseh, the sons of Joseph. You. You. And you. And as soon as you figure that out, and as soon as you understand that, then you'll understand that all these prophecies are talking about you. Thank you.
The 2300 Days of Hell is one of the most terrifying books of our day. You will learn who the people of Daniel are and why they are reaping the curses of Leviticus 26. You will learn why the prophecy in Daniel 9 verses 24 through 27 has nothing to do with Jesus and everything to do with King David. You will learn when the 13 tribes of Israel are going to be destroyed in the middle of this 120th and Jubilee cycle we are in right now. You will learn when the 2300 days of Daniel begin and how they show you when the two witnesses start to rescue the remnant of the 13 tribes of Israel from the beast power and captivity. This then leads to the murder of the two witnesses in this remnant fleeing into the wilderness during the last 3.5 years of the tribulation. You will learn what the covenant made with many really is, when it began, when it ends, and just how big this thing is, and how involved you are. What you're about to learn in this book is going to scare you and cause you to weep for your loved ones who will not obey. Once you read the 2300 Days of Hell, you will understand the significance of the events on the nightly news and how it's going to affect you and your family. Once you read the 2300 Days of Hell, you will never look at prophecy the same way again. Is it possible to know where the 10 lost tribes went? Does history show them using another name other than Israel? Did you know history records large groups of people leaving Egypt for Greece before Moses and the Exodus? Are you aware that the Israelites were called Bet Kumri by the Assyrians? After the captivity, they were called Gomerians by their captors. Other people called these same people Gomerians, and later on they were known as the Sumerians. In these people was a group of people known as the Amerigeans. Out of the Sumerians came the Celtic and the Gaulish people, and today we know them as the Celts. Some of the Celtic people are known as the Anglo and Saxons, son of Isaac. The Gaelic people come from the port of Gaul, better known as Portugal today. Before this, they were found in Zaragoza, Spain. And before that, they were from those same Greeks that fled Egypt before Moses and the Exodus. Did you know your own family crest can show you from what tribe of Israel you are from? The red hand on the flag of Ireland tells the story of Tamar and the birth of Zerah sticking out his hand before Phares. This is the same Zerah that Zaragoza is named after. The unicorn on the crest of England shows Israel as the unicorn in captivity by the chain around its neck and the line of Judah with the crown on it. Why has Ireland the harp of King David for its national emblem? Why has Scotland got the same symbol as Judah, a lion, but Scotland's is red? How is the Norwegian lion or the Dutch lion and their crests tied into this? Are you aware of your rich and exciting history and how prophecy is speaking about you in these last days? It is time for you to know who you are, and you can prove it from your own encyclopedias once you know what to look for.
Joseph F. Dumont explores every question about the sabbatical and jubilee years in Remembering the Sabbatical Year, 2016. In order to understand the truth, you have to expose those things that are not true. What is left is then the facts. Remembering the Sabbatical Years examines all the theories put forward as to when the sabbatical years were, and then using your own Bible shows you how to be able to prove it for yourself. Once you do this, then you too can understand prophecy and in what season the Messiah is to come. Filled with groundbreaking insights, remembering the sabbatical years of 2016 is both a source of wisdom and practical knowledge on an important yet complex subject and a necessary guidebook for prevailing through today's times. The Creator of the universe has set upon His creation a construct of keeping time, and within that construct of keeping time, He has also given certain instructions. These markers of time have everything to do with prophecy as well, for they are the language by which boundaries are set and milestones are crossed. Prophecy affects every living human being on the planet, and so the reader becomes the main character in this book. We have, for all the world, an example of a people who kept and also did not keep the Sabbath years as instructed, and you will see what happened to them in each of these cases. You cannot afford to be ignorant of these things. The curses for not keeping the sabbatical years are happening now all around us, and they are getting worse. We are to wrestle with the Word to get the truth. Get your copy today and begin to understand world events today from a biblical understanding.